Hey guys, this is Frankie Edgar, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
Hey, this is Rich Franklin.
What's up, everybody? This is Chris Lieben.
This is Diego Sanchez.
Randy Couture.
Alex Overeem.
Hi, this is Stephen Bonner.
This is Don Fry.
Hey, I'm Phil, Mr. Wonderful Davis.
TJ Dillashaw.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Welcome to the final episode of Submission Radio for 2015. Casper, what a year it's been. I mean, it's flown absolutely by. We've been across Adelaide, Melbourne for UFC 193 and some big episodes, and here we are at the final show of the year.
It has been an absolutely massive year for Submission Radio. We couldn't have done it without you guys, the listeners, so just want to say a big thank you to tuning in, and it's probably a perfect time because there's a massive episode of Submission Radio coming at you. We got four guests this week to wrap up the year. We've got none other than Randy Couture. He's going to be first on the show. A whole bunch of stuff to talk to Randy about. We want to get his opinion on a whole bunch of the latest topics currently in MMA, such as UFC 194, UFC 193, whole bunch of stuff to talk about there. Max Holloway, the big winner from UFC 194. We want to talk to him about what's next for him. And Johny Hendricks, he's scheduled to fight Stephen Wonderboy Thompson at UFC 196. We've got him on the show to talk about a whole bunch of stuff. And then we're going to be breaking down UFC on Fox 17, Rafael Dos Anjos versus Cerrone 2, the main card. And we've got none other than the associate editor from Bloody Elbow, Karim Zidan, joining us. So we're going to be talking about that whole show with him and, of course, his crazy adventures in Russia and, of course, the whole Fedor situation with Ryzen. So it's a stacked show.
Yeah, I cannot wait. What a way to see our 2015. And guys, if you still haven't had the opportunity, jump on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/submissionradioau, and subscribe. We've got a bunch of content on there over the last couple of weekends. If you want to see some of Cerrone's scrums there, where he discusses McGregor, if you want to jump back and have a look at McGregor's post-fight press conference and some highlights of all the fighters and winners talking about some of the special moments over the weekend, make sure you check that out. And also jump on Twitter and follow us at SubmissionAUS. A bunch of gifts on there. We love our gifts here at Submission Radio. People are starting to take notice. Jump on there and see what kind of gifts and what kind of captions we can come up with. And also the Facebook page, facebook.com/SubmissionRadioAUS. That's where you give us your opinions. Feel free to message us. We've enjoyed talking to a lot of fans through the Facebook page, and keep messaging us. Sometimes we may be snowed under with work, but we promise we will get back to you, and we love the conversations that we have on there.
Yeah, we had someone email us recently, and then it was actually me who responded, or at least tried to. I wrote out this long email in response, and then when I went to click send, the mail just failed. I think the person who sent the email completely deleted their account. So don't do that. If you email us, we will respond to you. And if we can't get back to you, you know, we're not sending you spam or viruses, or, you know, just a genuine Submission Radio response. So no need to delete the email. But I'll tell you what, Dennis, you mentioned about communicating with us. There is one thing that you guys can do for us. If you are listening on iTunes or Stitcher or iTunes or SoundCloud or YouTube or wherever, feel free to give us a review, especially on iTunes. It does help us. It does help the program in terms of Google and SEO, and iTunes goes, this is a quality program people enjoy because they are rating it. 5 stars is appreciated, but you can give the show whatever you think we are worth. So definitely do that. If you're watching on YouTube, like Dennis mentioned, a ton of content, so don't forget to subscribe. We mentioned that this is the last Submission Radio for 2015. We'll be talking a bit about when we're returning later on at the very end of the episode, and it is a stacked one, so we're not going to waste any more time. We're getting straight into it. And Dennis, I believe our first guest is on the line.
Our next guest is an MMA legend with 6 UFC championships to his name. You may also recognize him from movies like Big Stan, Expendables, and The Scorpion King. He joins us now on Submission Radio. Randy Couture, welcome back to the program.
Thanks. Good to be back.
Yeah, it's great to have you back on the show. We saw you at the premiere of your friend Sylvester Stallone's movie Creed, Randy. We were so impressed with the movie and Stallone's performance. Just wondering, what did you think of it, and where does it rank for you with the previous Rocky films?
Well, it's a fantastic film, and I think it's certainly right up there with the very first Rocky installment. It's one of those films that had you on the edge of your seat, had you laughing, had you crying. It definitely stirred you up. It was a great film.
What do you think? Do you think Stallone has a chance here with the Golden Globes and possibly an Oscar?
I think he's definitely going to get a nomination. You know, it's always funny to see the films that are coming out when it starts to get to be Oscar season. It'll be interesting, but I definitely think there's a nomination in there for him. He did a fantastic job. Michael Jordan did an amazing job as the lead character, pulled it off physically and in every other way as well.
Speaking of Sylvester or Sly, Expendables 4 looks to be released in 2017. Just wondering, Randy, is there any small tidbit of news you can give us, and will you be returning in the film?
Well, I've heard that it's been greenlit, and we're supposed to start filming next October in 2016. I am still waiting on the script that I understand is being adapted to fit the Expendables. Always curious to see what direction we're going, and you know, what new characters might pop up and who might be filling those characters. Hard to believe that we could add any more after the last one, but you know, obviously Toll Road hasn't been killed, so I expect that he'll be back, and yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Obviously, it's a lot like old home week. We all start putting our gear on and all back together again. It's a lot of fun. It's a great group of guys.
Exactly. And just to confirm, like, would it be confirmed if Toll Road is in there, you'd be back, or is it one of those things where you'd have to have a look at the script and see if you're sort of happy with it?
No, I'm sure the story's going to be great. I don't think there's going to be any issue there. I'm not one of those guys that's going to hold out or any of that crap. I think everybody's excited to be a part of that property and part of such an amazing ensemble cast. So, you know, I hope I don't read the script and find out Toll Road gets killed in the first act or something.
Yeah.
You know, if that's the direction it goes, that's the direction it goes. I'll still be happy to be a part of it.
Randy, is it just us, or should Larry King be somehow involved in the fourth movie? Maybe he should be the main bad guy.
That's funny.
No comment from Randy. All right. Well, speaking of movies, we saw you've completed shooting your role in the upcoming movie Good Kids. You're playing a tough husband. Now, we imagine there wasn't much acting needed to portray this role.
Well, it's a very small part, and a fun cast of guys. You know, the younger cast of folks that and end up basically in a very interesting fight scene in the movie, which was kind of the fun part for me. And I think people are going to get a kick out of it. Again, it's a small part. The production company that did the film does a lot of movies, and sometimes in the industry, it's about making and building relationships and, you know, doing some things that maybe you wouldn't otherwise do. I liked the role. It made me laugh when I read it. And you know, it's just like doing the setup with 50 Cent and Bruce Willis. It was a very small part, but when you read something and it literally makes you laugh out loud, it's like, I got to do this. This is fun. This is going to be funny.
Well, I'm dating a girl from New Zealand, and sometimes, you know, they like the tough dudes. Now, I'm not her husband. I'm her boyfriend. But how is one a tough partner? What do I need to do? What kind of advice can you give me?
You know, I think women like that bad guy that you know, they know you can take care of business if it came to that. Mm-hmm. But I think at the end of the day, that's, you know, that's what's on the outside. I think they really like what's that soft inside, that, you know, you're attentive and you take care of them, you meet their needs whenever you can, and you know, if somebody gets out of line, you can straighten them up. I think that's, you know, walking that fine line. But I don't think they want to be mistreated or you know, have a douchebag, frankly, that treats them poorly. Mm-hmm. I think they just want a guy that can protect them and take care of them if he needs to.
So basically, good. I have no chance. Thanks, Randy.
too much dish. Now, even though you've been busy shooting movies, Randy, we're sure you've been keeping an eye on some of the craziness in the world of MMA. Obviously, we have to ask you about your thoughts on certain things, such as Conor McGregor dethroning Jose Aldo in 13 seconds at UFC 194. You know, when we read it, it's still a bit crazy. Did you expect to see McGregor winning, or were you surprised? What were your thoughts, Randy?
I was a bit surprised. Well, certainly surprised that it went as fast as it did. I mean, 13 seconds, that's amazing.
Mm.
And I think just chances of that happening again, I mean, it's just so rare with two top fighters to have them moving at each other at the same time and actually hit each other at the same time.
Mm.
And to have Aldo go down like that was just very, very surprising. You know, I felt like so many others that Conor McGregor really hadn't been tested by a top flight mixed martial artist yet. And yeah, I love Chad Mendez, and I think that was, you know, if given a full camp and an opportunity to prepare for a full title fight with Conor, it might have been a different outcome that night. But Chad ran out of gas after the first round. But I think at the end of the day, he showed the blueprint on what's going to give Conor trouble. Taking him down, putting him on his back, you know, dropping elbows on him, smothering him. And, you know, he's dynamic, certainly dynamic with his mouth outside the cage, but dynamic in his fighting style inside the cage. He showed that time and time again, and that's fun to watch.
He had a movement coach, which was interesting, but McGregor wants to move up to lightweight and be a dual champion. It kind of reminds us of a guy that we knew who was a light heavyweight and heavyweight champion during his career. Although he didn't hold both at the same time, Randy, do you think it's possible for McGregor to be a dual champion? And do you think he'd be successful in the lightweight division?
Yep. I certainly think it's possible. I don't think that's outside the realm of possibility for other guys to talk about doing it. You know, obviously nobody's pulled that off and maintained two title belts at the same time. I suspect it would be a little easier in the lighter weights because those weight classes are so much closer together. But they are very deep. I mean, both those weight classes are terribly deep with talent. And sometimes styles, as you know, make the fights. So it'll be interesting to see how that progresses and if that's where he ends up.
What do you think about the logistics of the situation, Randy? Like, let's say, back in the day you held the light heavyweight title and the heavyweight title at the same time. Do you think, you know, it would be tough for any promotion to sort of have somebody do that and let them defend both of them? Like, do you think he'd be able to hold both at the same time, or would he have to vacate one?
I think it's possible in this day and age with so many shows and so many fighters and all the other weight classes for it to be done, to defend both titles. You know, at different times, given the proper time to prepare for that next opponent in whatever weight class, I think that could be done. It would certainly be a juggling act, and you would need the cooperation of the promotion to do that. It's possible.
Well, while on the subject of UFC 194, there was a bit of controversy, Randy, when the UFC released locker room footage of Jose Aldo post-fight. In the video, Aldo is crying on the ground with a towel over his head. I'm just wondering, as someone who's been with the company for so long in Jose Aldo and was the first ever featherweight champion in the UFC, what did you think about the UFC releasing this kind of footage?
Well, I mean, we could probably go down the list of fighters that have not been shown or been kind of dumped on by the promotion. I don't think at the end of the day the promotion cares that much. I don't think they had Jose Aldo's best interest at heart there. Mm. They have George St. Pierre's best interest at heart, and that was after a victory. But because he wanted to take a hiatus, all the things that were said and done with regard to George, I certainly might fall into that category if I wanted to start talking about that. But there's certainly been other fighters that, you know, they do what they think is best for them at the end of the day.
Do you think, sorry to interrupt, Kaz, do you think footage from the locker room should be released? I mean, it seems like a pretty private place. I've been in a locker room before with a fighter that I've managed, and I've been in the situation where they've lost, and I've seen some of the emotional responses. And, you know, Muhammad Ali famously said, no one knows what to say in the loser's locker room. You know, do you think it's too far? Do you think it's overstepping the boundaries, letting people into that part of it?
Here's my question. Where were his handlers? Where were his trainers? Those are the guys, and having been in that situation, you know, after the Chuck Liddell fight and after retiring in the third Chuck Liddell fight, you know, my guys weren't letting those guys in. You know, that was our space. They wanted me to have that space. And I remember specifically Nate Corey hollering at the cameraman and telling them, look, get out of here, and not letting them in the room. You know, I think that it is what it is. You know, we all have to deal with defeats in this sport, and it'll be interesting, I think more interesting, to see how Jose responds to this adversity and shows that kind of true championship spirit that we expect him to have and come back with all guns blazing and make a run at it again. That's what's more important to me than, you know, sure, of course he's upset, and in his locker room and in a private moment, yeah, that maybe shouldn't be shown or filmed, but, you know, it is what it is. It's part of the sport.
Sure. I also want to get your perspective on something, Randy, because Conor McGregor, he's one of the biggest stars in MMA at the moment, if not the biggest. It's basically him and Ronda up there. And, you know, he's been talking about obviously negotiating a big deal. You in the past, you had sort of your back and forth with the UFC. There were certain things that you wanted to achieve in your career. And people are talking about Conor McGregor possibly being bigger than the UFC in a sense, where he could be such a big star that he could not necessarily control the UFC, but, you know, maybe sort of, I guess, demand certain things. What do you think about that notion? Is it possible ever for a fighter to sort of be that big, you know, kind of like a Mayweather, where he's sort of calling his own shots? Is it possible to do that in the UFC?
Well, it all boils down to leverage. And certainly in a combative sport, as volatile as it is, as individual as it is, you still got to go out there and win. Right now, he's got leverage. You know, I'm not sure where he's at in his fight contract, how many fights he has left, or if he's due to negotiate a new one now. But he's sitting there as the unified champ in a very volatile and talented weight class. He's not only walked the walk, but, you know, obviously talked the talk first and backed it up. And the media and the public have kind of gone crazy for all of that. So, you know, that gives him a ton of leverage to make specific monetary demands, to put clauses and things in his contract that maybe other fighters wouldn't have the leverage to do. Because, frankly, there's a fighter standing on every street corner right now. Mm. And if they don't want to deal with you, they don't want to meet the demands, or you're too demanding, you don't have any leverage. They'll just find somebody else to take the spot. So he's in a unique position. And what he is able to do and how much power he actually exerts on them is, you know, yet to be seen. I've seen the numbers being thrown around, the $100 million and all this other stuff, and it'll be interesting. It'll be see how it shakes out and how much leverage he actually does have over the promotion.
Well, I mean, yeah, $100 million contract, that's insane, and it would kind of show how far the sport's come. He's also talked about doing co-promotion with the UFC. Do you think that would ever happen, or do you think that's just a bit, I don't know, ridiculous to say?
Well, I know that was a huge stumbling block with Fedor and trying to sign Fedor back when I was pursuing that fight specifically as a contracted fighter with the UFC, and that was the fight I told them that I wanted. I was ranked number two in the world. He was ranked number one at the world at the time. I know they negotiated with him for a long time, but M1 Global wanted a co-promotion and they were kind of handling and managing, representing Fedor. And that was a stumbling block. They were like, no, we're not going to put anybody else over. We don't need another promotion. We don't need a co-promotion. We're the UFC, and that's it. And so I would be very surprised if that happens. I would be interested in to hear that conversation and how that would get by.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how it all plays out. Now, another big topic we never got a chance to talk to you about and get your thoughts on was a little event that happened here in Melbourne, Australia. We're not sure if you heard of it. It was called UFC 193. Big attendance. I don't know, kind of a big deal. Anyway, moving on. You weren't here. It's okay. It was quite a good party.
Yeah, well, it was a UFC, so that would explain why I wasn't allowed to be in attendance.
Well, snuck you in through the background. We know people in Melbourne.
Well, it's a fine wig and some big sunglasses, maybe.
Oh, yeah. Me and Cash would just give you our accessories. We just wear that all the time anyway. But obviously, during the main event of the fight, Ronda Rousey lost to Holly Holm. It was a huge, huge shock to the MMA world. Now, John Jones brought up the point that if Ronda Rousey gets an immediate rematch, then it should only be fair to Aldo to get one as well. What do you think? Do you think he has a point? Is if one person gets an immediate rematch after being beaten so dominantly, should Jose Aldo get a rematch as well after being the first champion and not being beaten in so many years?
Well, certainly you can make a case for that. And there's probably, in Ronda's contract, there was probably language that stated as much. Which is, we'll be curious to see if Jose had that same language in his contract, because if it's not there, then he's at the discretion of the promotion, who obviously loves Conor McGregor and all the media and attention that he's bringing to them and to the sport. So I would be surprised if the language isn't there for a rematch, that he would get it right out of the gate. because there's potential that Conor could lose that. And then what's that do for the promotion? Obviously, whoever represented Ronda probably negotiated for that rematch clause in the contract. And not that she didn't deserve it, because she has been, in my opinion, their number one star for quite a while now. I was surprised. I thought Holly would be the first one to really hit Ronda. Mm. And I thought that she would give Ronda problems with the footwork. She demonstrated amazing footwork and elusive with just about every other fighter that she's fought. I knew she wasn't going to be half crazy and run right at Ronda like some of these other girls have tried and kind of ran right into her wheelhouse. I was surprised when Ronda did get her hands on her and got her on the ground that Holly dealt with it so well and was able to, you know, kind of shed Ronda off and get back up and get her back, you know, where she needed to have her, which was in that striking realm. I thought by the third or fourth round, Ronda would have figured out the footwork and gotten her hands on her and found a way to submit her like she's done so many others. So Holly had an amazing performance and has just demonstrated a ton of class in how she's dealt with Ronda and the media and all the kind of shock and awe of winning that event. And I think, you know, there are occasions where we all kind of need some humble pie, and I think that's probably where Ronda's sitting right now.
Sure. I'm just wondering, from a rematch perspective, everybody obviously assumes that the rematch will do big money. You know, this talks about possibly doing UFC 200. Do you think, sort of, from a competitive aspect and as a sort of mixed martial artist, do you think it makes sense? Do you think Ronda can go back and make the necessary adjustments if she was to fight in, say, July, which is really only about 6 months away?
Yes, I think she can make the adjustments she needs to make. And it's purely a function of focus and game plan. I think after knocking her last opponent out, I think she was maybe a little overconfident with her striking. Didn't give Holly the credit that Holly deserved as a world-class boxer and kickboxer. And went out and kind of tried to strike with her and paid the price with a southpaw that had a great jab and great footwork and was elusive and just kept tagging her. So I think those are things that can be fixed. Change the footwork, change her approach to closing the distance and getting her hands on Holly, and then making Holly operate where she's strongest. How many judo medalists do we have in the sport, grapplers at that level do we have in the sport? Mm. Time and time again, that's where she's won her fights. And it looked to me like she thought she was going to be able to go out and strike with a world-class boxer. Mm. And that's always a bad idea. Would have been a bad idea for me to do it with James Toney.
Yeah.
I think it was a bad idea for her to do it with Holly Holm.
Wow, imagine that. Now, one of the other top contenders for the title is obviously a friend and a member of your team, Extreme Couture, and Miesha Tate. For those that may have not been paying attention, she was actually meant to fight Ronda Rousey before they replaced her with Holly Holm. And me and Casper, we spoke to Dana White after she suggested she might retire and after she got snubbed for the shot. And Dana White said if she's thinking about retirement, she probably should. I'm just wondering, right, Randy, what do you think about the way the UFC has handled the situation with Miesha Tate?
Well, again, I think it's a shame. As hard as Miesha works and as much as she's done for the sport and for the women's division, that she got overlooked. You know, you look at the guys that Conor McGregor stepped over to get his title shots. And obviously he backed it up. And Holly Holm has certainly backed it up when nobody thought she would. But it's still, I mean, why have rankings if you're not going to honor them? And kind of use that, you know, it just doesn't make a lot of sense. So I understand Miesha's frustration. I don't think it's really fair. Again, it doesn't make sense why you would even post rankings and have ranked fighters if you're not going to go by those rankings. What good are they? Mm. So, I don't know if Miesha's really going to retire. I know she's getting a little bit of a taste of doing some of the entertainment and acting stuff and seems to enjoy it. I think she still has contribution in the women's division. She's amazingly talented and a hard worker. So it's really what's in her heart that's most important. But yeah, I think she should have, you know, even though it would have been a third installment of Ronda and Miesha, I thought, you know, her last outing, she took Ronda to the fourth round. No one's gone that far with Ronda to that point. she'd earned the spot.
Mm. The other thing is also the notion, Randy, that you know, Dana White said, if the R word, if retirement is in your mind, then you should probably retire. And I don't know how direct that was sort of at Miesha, but more of a general statement. Obviously, you retired a few times. What do you think about that notion? If a fighter is thinking about retirement, is that like a red flag? Should they be retiring because they're thinking about it? Or is there sort of room to be thinking about it, I guess?
Well, I guess the question. Yeah, and yeah, I retired twice. I retired after the third Chuck fight for personal reasons, and then later came back, felt like I had more to do and more to accomplish, and things fell into place. I retired this last time because I felt like it was the right thing to do for me, and I've been pretty happy with that decision. I'm not sure what Miesha was vocalizing, if that statement came out of her frustration by not getting her shot at being the best in her division, or if she genuinely feels like, she's not having fun anymore and she doesn't want to grind out another camp and so that, I think there lies the answer. What's really going on? If she genuinely feel like, she's gone as far as she can and she's not having fun anymore, then yeah, it probably is time to retire. But if that was a statement just out of frustration because she wasn't getting a fair shake from the promotion, then that's another thing.
Mm. Last question on the topic, Randy, because we know you're a busy man and we need to let you go very soon. It looks like Ronda may not be ready in time for UFC 200. She said she has issues eating an apple. So my question to you is, do you think Miesha Tate should fight Holly Holm in the meantime? And how do you think a fight between Tate and Holm go, in your opinion?
Well, I think that the next ranked opponent, if Ronda's, not ready for the immediate rematch, and, breaking your jaw is no joke. I've had friends that have done it. I'm glad I got through my fight career without doing it. Mm. It's not a fun place to be. I think if she's honest and she's not ready, then she shouldn't fight until she feels like she is ready. And then you go to the next person in the rankings. And that would, in my opinion, I think is Miesha Tate. And it would be interesting. I think Miesha's a smart, diligent fighter. I think she has the grappling and wrestling ability to exploit that possible weakness in Holly's game. I don't think she's going to go out and try and stand around and strike with Holly Holm at all, especially after what Holly demonstrated against Ronda. So it's an interesting fight, and that, therein lies the business decision and the problems that the promotion has, is what's good for them, what's going to continue to make them money and put butts in the seats. They don't always take the fighters into consideration when they're putting that equation together. It's about what's going to be sensational and what's going to be a good business decision for them.
Mm. Appreciate the insight, Randy. Finally, as we wrap up, we know you're based out of Vegas. What are the Couture family plans for Christmas? Will we perhaps see Randy dressed as Santa Claus this year?
I haven't gotten that far out of shape. No, I won't be Santa Claus. I'm up in the mountains in Colorado. I'm relaxing and enjoying the mountains, the snow, and the fresh air up here. Headed to Nashville for New Year's Eve to celebrate New Year's in Nashville. Never done that before, so I'm expecting that's going to be a lot of fun. And I'll go from there to Washington, D.C. to meet some of the guys in the hospital that are dealing with their injuries from the war on terror and give away some of the foundation money that we've raised this last year. So that's going to be a good week as well.
Yeah, that's wonderful, Randy. Just for the people that are listening in the U.S. who don't know where to go to donate, what's the best place to go donate to that foundation?
XCGIF.org. That stands for Extreme Couture GI Foundation.org. And you can go there and find out what our events we have coming up and donate to the foundation there.
Well, there you go, guys. You have to jump on there. Make sure you donate. It's a fantastic foundation. Nothing but the best that we've heard from people from it. And Randy, thank you so much for coming on the program. Guys, you can follow Randy on Twitter at Randy_Couture. It's always an honor to have you on the program, and have a great Christmas and New Year, Randy.
Thanks, you too.
Okay, this is Alistair Overeem, and you are listening to Submission Radio.
Alright guys, joining us here on Submission Radio is a UFC 194 winner, winning all four of his fights in 2015. His most recent victory came against Jeremy Stevens. Coming to us right from Hawaii, his first time on Submission Radio. It's a pleasure to welcome Max Holloway to the program. Max, how are you?
Good, man. How are you guys?
Very well, Max. Now, it's only a week removed from your big win over Jeremy. How did you celebrate your big win in Vegas? We hear Vegas was taken over by thousands of Irish fans post-fight.
It was crazy, man. But, you know, I got some good eats. Mm-hmm. You know, I did a little bit of gambling, you know. But the hotel wasn't too crazy after. The hotel was pretty empty after the fight. You know, it went crazy for like maybe an hour or 2 hours or so. And then after that, when I got down, because I got rid of the pressure and stuff, it was pretty fun.
Mm. You say you did a bit of gambling. What's your game, Max? Are you blackjack? Are you poker? And did you win a lot of money?
You know, I played, a craps.
Uh-huh.
Craps, mm-hmm. Craps is my game, man. I love rolling dice, but, we see, I was making most of my money on top of, red or black on top of the roulette table, though. I'd go craps and wouldn't do too good, and then I'd just shoot a lot of money on top of red or black, and, you know, that's the way I was making most of my money.
Now, Max, the big fight between you and Jeremy was very, very close. What were your thoughts during of your performance in the fight, and did any part of you worry that Jeremy was going to get his hand raised when the decision was read out?
You know, there's always a little scared, you know. You don't know what – you got to be skeptical, you know, with these MMA judges, you know. You don't know what they're looking at sometimes. And, yeah, I was a little nervous, but, you know, I thought I won the fight. You know, I was countering, I was moving well, and I was landing, I feel like I was landing more punches, you know, so it wasn't your normal Max Holloway fight, but it is what it is, and I just happy I got away with a dub, you know. I wanted a finish, but some things hold me back, and, you know, I didn't get the finish, but, you know, I was confident that I had the win, and then when they did the decision, I heard unanimous, then it made me more confident that I had the win, and, you know, I got my hand raised and I was happy.
You say it wasn't your typical Max Holloway fight. You know, you fought quite a lot in this past year. How is that affecting you? Are you sort of starting to feel the burn of fighting so much?
You know, I'll fight tomorrow if I have to, you know, but, you know, my body's taking it, you know. I can feel it, you know. I got a little bit injuries this fight, you know, and, you know, I think it's time to, you know, simmer down a little, you know, so we see what happens, you know, but definitely I can feel the effects of four fights, you know, in 1 year, and, you know, I just can't wait to rest a little, you know. There's the holidays, enjoy, and then we go from there.
Sorry to cut in there, Dennis. I was going to say, you say, you know, simmer down a little. What kind of turnaround are you sort of looking for? How soon would you like to get back? If they offered you something early in the year, say, you know, February, March, would that be too early for you?
You know, yeah, I feel like that would be too early, you know. I was looking more towards May or June, you know, ending May, late June, so I can start training maybe in February, you know, for a fight. So we see what happens, though, you know. If UFC calls, I'm not going to turn it down. I'm a fighter, you know. That's the way I pay my bills, and I'm going to fight, you know. It's in me.
Mm. It's interesting because you're very young. You're 24 years old, but you started fighting at a very young age as well. A lot of people look at a fighter's age to see sort of how long they have left and how their body's feeling, but because you have been fighting for such a long time, are you noticing that your body's starting to have some issues, any little injuries or nagging pains that you have to deal with?
Yeah, you know, it just comes with the sport, though, you know. It's like, I'm 24, thank God I'm young, but, you know, my coaches always tease me, you know, by the time I hit their ages when I'm like 30, 35, I'm going to have a body of a 60-year-old, they always tell me, but... But, you know, it is what it is. It comes with the sport, and, you know, I take care of my body well. You know, I go get daily, weekly massages, weekly chiropractor. You know, I try to do cryotherapy a lot. So, you know, I got to take care of my body today.
Before we talk about sort of what's next for you, we obviously got to cover the main event of UFC 194. You know, the event saw your past opponent, Conor McGregor, beat Jose Aldo in 13 seconds. Pretty shocking conclusion to a fight built up for almost a year. What did you think of the fight? What are your thoughts on it?
You know, it was crazy, you know, 13 seconds, you know, dethroning the champ, just, you know, landing that punch. I was in shock, you know. I thought that was going to go and be in a war, but, you know, I've been saying, man, these 4-ounce gloves, they're totally unforgiving, man. They can change your life really quick, so... I feel for the champ, you know, though, but, you know, a reign to come down like that, a reign as his long come down that way, you know, it's kind of sad, but it is what it is, you know. It shakes up the division, and we see what happens.
What do you think that does for his legacy? He's been fighting for a long time. How do you think this affects Jose Aldo's legacy?
I don't think it affects it at all. You know, he still was the number one pound for pound guy. He still did what he did, you know. But it's sad that this sport only goes off of your last fight, you know, and his last fight just so happened to be him getting knocked out, you know, which is a shitty outcome. But I think it doesn't affect it, you know. It's just, you know, this sport period is hard, you know. It's like when you're the man, you're the man. And then when something like this happened, and everybody's so fast to criticism, you know. So so it's a sad thing.
Many people are still wondering and trying to look over the fight to see if the pressure got to Aldo. Obviously, a massive build-up, a million press conferences. What are your thoughts on the matter? Do you think it was a bit of a mental head game that got to Aldo in this fight?
No, you know, I don't think it was a mental head game. I just think it was a nice counter punch that just so happened right on the spot, and you know, the lights turned off. You know, it's like, you know, I guess Aldo looked ready. You know, he had a game plan. He landed his left hook when he got landed on his when the left hand landed of Conor. He landed his left hook. It just so happened Conor was in the more right position to land a punch. You know, and then you go to sleep.
You said that it sort of shakes up the division. I mean, obviously it's unfortunate when a fighter loses, especially for the fighter themselves, but do you think it's kind of an exciting thing? It's a good thing for the division because a lot of matchups now, they become a lot more fresh than they would have been in the past.
Yeah, you know, for sure, you know. So the division is wide open now, and, you know, we see what happens, you know. I'm excited. I can't wait, you know. Hopefully I can get that rematch with Conor. But there's a lot of fights for me here. You know, there's a lot of fights left for Conor here too. So we just see what happens.
Well, speaking of potential fights for you, one of the ones that people are talking about, like Joe Rogan, is a potential fight against Jose Aldo for your next fight. I mean, how would you feel about a fight like that? Would that be something that you welcome? And also, how would you think a fight between you and Jose Aldo would go?
You know, I think it'd be one for ages, you know. Jose likes to fight. I like to come and fight and stand up, and he likes stand up. So I think it would be a fun one. You know, I think it would sell a lot of numbers too, you know, a lot of tickets. So we see, you know, I'm just waiting for see what UFC wants, you know, if that's the fight they want and that gets me closer to a title shot, why not?
Well, there's talk of McGregor taking off some time, possibly taking, you know, a lightweight fight. If you got an opportunity, would you want to fight, say, Frankie Edgar for a number one contender's position? We know you've been sort of calling that fight out, you know, in your last two post-fight interviews.
You know, I'd love to get that fight too. You know, Frankie Edgar's another big name, and I think if I can get that name, a win over his name, you know, I definitely. Helps my title shot stuff, you know. Me and him are like the contenders right now inside the 145 division, and you know, it's up in the air who gets the next title shot. So I'd love to fight him, you know, earn my way.
You mentioned that it would be a fight to avenge the BJ Penn fight, the loss that he had against Frankie previously. How important is it for you to avenge that BJ Penn loss?
You know, it's just one for the Hawaiians, you know. I try to get one for the Hawaiians back, you know. It's he left a bad taste for us Hawaiians, you know, not, you know, three times. So, of course, if I had a chance to try and defend it and get one back for Hawaiians, then I think that would be cool, you know, and I think that would be great for the Hawaiians. And I think that fight would sell a lot of numbers too, you know, the classic Hawaiians versus New Jerseyans, I guess.
Do you feel like this is almost like a continuation, like BJ Penn sort of tags out, Max Holloway tags in? And also, how just paint us a bit of a picture, because obviously we're all the way here in Australia. How big would a fight like that be for Hawaii?
It'll be huge, you know. You know how, I guess the biggest way to compare it is, you know, like, you know, of course Ireland is bigger than Hawaii, but, you know, Conor and those guys, how to get behind them, I think. A fight with Max Holloway versus Frankie Edgar, a lot of Hawaiians would get behind me a lot more, you know. They'd be like, well, how this Hawaiian kid is fighting Frankie, you know. Hopefully he can get one back for the Hawaiians, and, you know, they jump on the train and we see what happens, you know. It'd be big. It'd be big for Hawaii, you know. That's why I really want it down in. They want a big fight inside of, for UFC Hawaii, you know. There's only two fights or three fights, you know. It's going to be that Conor versus Holloway, Edgar versus Holloway, or Aldo versus Holloway. That's the only three fights that's big enough, I think, that we can bring down to Hawaii and do it, you know?
Mm-hmm. Do you think it's a bit overdue for the UFC to come to Hawaii?
Oh, yeah. I think it's long overdue, man. They need to hurry up and get down here.
Speaking of McGregor, he recently in the post-fight press conference after UFC 194 spoke about his plans on being a dual champion and being in both divisions. Does it at all worry you, though, that if he does go up to lightweight, it might jam up your shot for the featherweight title?
We see, you know, who knows, you know, he's like, yeah, he's a champion, but that's just it, you know, he's a champion in the UFC, he's not the CEO or the, or Lorenzo Fertitta, you know, I don't think so, we see, you know, I don't know if they're going to stop the whole division for him and let him go, you know, I hear in talks of if he goes up, he gets the direct shot, but he gets stripped, you know, I don't think he's the one, I don't think he's the one to say, oh, you can't strip me, you know, the UFC can really do whatever they want, so. See what happens.
It's interesting because you say that, you know, he's not a CEO, and yet that's kind of what he says he's aiming for. He's aiming to sort of have, I don't know if you'd call it McGregor Promotions, but he wants to co-promote with the UFC, and I guess he wants to, I guess, have more power and a bigger role. What do you think about that? Is it even possible? Could he take the Mayweather route and almost co-promote?
You know, the Mayweather route, you know, if you can promote like that, you know, it's because of... you'd be able to do that because there's another promotion doing it. You know, there's Golden Boy Promotions is doing it and another promotion. There's a bunch of promotions in boxing doing it. Mm-hmm. And the big ones just so happen to be Golden Boy and Mayweather, you know. But, you know, UFC is privately owned. You know, they own their Zuffa, they own themselves. So I don't know how that promoting business would go. You know, I think Dana White doesn't even like people having managers. So I don't and Lorenzo and stuff, you know, like, you know, Dana always says publicly that, you know, managers is hard to work with sometimes, so I don't know how McGregor think he'd get away with promoting stuff, you know, and actually doing good for the guys he'd be promoting, so I don't know, man. I don't think it works.
Well, let's just talk about you guys rematching, because you fought previously and you lost to Conor McGregor. How badly do you want to get a rematch with him, especially after everything that he's accomplished in the division since you guys fought initially?
You know, I want to get back all my losses, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm not a loser, you know. It's like they left a bad taste in my mouth, so I want to get it back, you know, so I can be like, look, I got one back, you know, and so on. So we... You know, of course I want to fight him. He got the gold belt, and the end goal, that's my gold belt. And it just so happened I already have a loss to a guy, so that'd be even sweeter, you know, to get to run it back again. So we see what happens, man. You know, I would love to fight really bad, and I got two other losses in the UFC that I'd love to fight them too, you know. So we just, you know, one step at a time, and I can't wait.
Yeah, with that McGregor loss, I mean, I'm guessing you probably went back and looked at the footage of the fight. How do you think it would be different if you guys had a rematch? How would you see that fight going now, all these years later?
You know, McGregor's a different fighter from then. I'm a different fighter from then. So we see, man. You know, it's everybody tell me I'm an excuse. Oh, I'm making an excuse or whatever. But you know, he talked about his fucking blown ACL or whatever, which I totally do not believe, because if you had a blown ACL, you probably wouldn't be able to walk and whatever, so let alone fight. So I was tripping out that how people believe him, and people say that he was injured for the whole fight. He was only injured for the last round. He got hurt in the last 10 seconds of the last round. And then when I fought, I hurt my ankle in the first 30 seconds of the first round, you know, and that really did mess me up. I couldn't move. I usually move out there, but if you go watch that fight, I hardly move. I stand in front of him. I move straight back. I move straight forward, and that's not what Max Holloway usually does, you know. So it'd be a different fight, way different fight from what it was from then to now, you know. So, and I think they know it, you know. I think his whole team knows that it'd be a great fight, you know. So we'll see what happens. I'm just waiting for the call, and hopefully it's soon.
It's interesting because the ACL is something that seems like it's plagued McGregor a little bit. He had it in your fight, and obviously against Chad Mendes, he says that he was 80% torn. You say that you don't really buy that as an excuse. What do you think? Do you think it's possible as far as the Chad Mendes fight as well that he had a partially torn ACL?
See, like, partially torn, you know, it is what it is. I understand a partially torn one. You know, partially torn, you can still move, but you can't move your laterally, side to side. You can't move. you can't move with a partial turn because that means he's going to buckle and stuff, you know. But him, like his camp and him or whatever, his fans think so. He blew, like his whole ACL was blown out when he fought me, which is just blew my mind because you see this humongous athletes, NFL players, blow their ACL and they're crying like, you know, like little kids. When and they can't even step on it. And this guy was fighting on it for 5 minutes, you know, it's ridiculous. I don't know. I don't even. And then if you look at the timeline of when we fought and you got that blown ACL thing, whatever, it takes like 9 months, 9 to 12 months to recover. And that's just to recover, you know, that's after the surgery or whatever. That's just to recover. And then probably sore long with doing the rehab and stuff. But he fought within 9 months after we fought, I think. I think it was 9 months or 10 months. But he fought within a year, I think, when he fought that whoever he fought after me. So, you know, my mind is just blown, man. I don't know where these guys coming up with this injury. I swear he's injured after every fight. He comes out saying he has an injury. So we see what happens, man.
Last question on the McGregor topic. If you did get a fight with him at Croke Park in Ireland, would you take it? Because you'd be fighting in front of a hostile crowd and probably one of the loudest crowds in the Irish.
I don't care, man. I'll take it. I don't care where it would be. I'll take it wherever they want it. And Croke Park would be just the icing on the cake, you know. You guys would think I'm lying, but you know, I think I have a lot of Irish fans, you know. It's the Irish is super nice to me. You know, I went there for Dublin for that fight night, and you know, that was cool. And then this past fight, that was cool. You know, they was chanting my name when I fought, so it was pretty cool, you know. And I understand it comes to the territory, you know. When I'm up there, they're probably gonna go for their countrymen, and that's one thing I respect about their culture and their fighting, that they're so loyal to their countrymen. But you know, at the end of the day, a fight is a fight. You know, there's only gonna have one person in there with me and a referee, so all that doesn't bother me. You know, when I fought him in Boston, it was kind of mind-blowing already, you know, how much fans he had there and whatever. So I think Croke Park wouldn't be too different.
Obviously, you know, you say you've got a lot of Irish fans. Obviously, anyone who's fighting McGregor, anyone at all, would obviously be booed against McGregor. But I don't know. Correct me if I'm wrong, Max, but I almost feel like you obviously caught at Frank Edgar in Hawaii, a lot of local fans there of yours. But then McGregor and Croke Park, I almost feel like you're taking it as almost like a big challenge. Like you're going in there head first to sort of, you know, have the crowd against you. You know, am I sort of right in saying that? Or you sort of want to go in there in enemy territory to take on that big challenge?
You know, I want that, you know, I want that. It's the icing on cake, you know. What would be a bigger win, you know? Me fighting him at Vegas or me fighting him at Croke Park, you know? Of course, Croke Park is cooler, you know? That's a stadium, that's a big, that's a stadium, you know? It sits a lot of people, there's a lot of his fans that's going to be there, you know, a lot of his countrymen, so let's do it, you know. This is fighting, man. At the end of the day, it is what it is. Everybody can yell, everybody can scream, and people can talk shit to me on top of Twitter, run their mouth or whatever. I don't care. No one takes that step in that cage. Only one other guy takes that step in the cage in there at me, you know. And I gotta fight one guy. I'm not fighting thousands of people. I'm fighting one person, one human being. That if I was to cut him, and I was to cut him, he was to cut me, we both would bleed. So, it is what it is, man. Fighting is fighting.
Well, Max, to wrap up the interview, we're going to do something with you we call the Submission Radio Tap Out Round. It's basically like a word association, a bunch of fun questions, and you answer with the first things that come to your mind, okay? So are you ready?
Yes, do it.
All right. Well, after watching UFC 194, is Max Holloway getting a movement coach?
No.
No movement coach for Max. All right. Will Max Holloway, here's an easy one. Will Max Holloway watch the new Star Wars?
Yes.
All right, here's the tough one part of that question. Skywalker, Darth Vader, or Han Solo? Make your decision wisely, Max.
I got to go with Skywalker.
There you go. Best advice a coach has ever given you?
Would probably be have fun.
Has Max Holloway done his Christmas shopping already, or will there be an Arnold Schwarzenegger last-minute jingle all the way situation happening?
Oh, that is funny you bring this up, because my wife was just bothering me all week to watch this movie.
Really? Jingle All the Way?
Yeah. That's her favorite movie from when she was a kid, so She's been trying to bother me. We need to have a movie night and watch that movie. But, you know, I need to get one more person left, and that's my wife. So it's probably going to be to honor Schwarzenegger way and, you know, end up fighting someone over something.
Yeah, I don't think anyone wants to fight you in a store for like a toy. And also, you use the word bother, but when you're talking about Jingle All the Way, I don't think you can really use bother. It's more like a treat to watch that movie.
You picked your wife right, man. You picked your wife right.
Speaking of Arnie, though, give us your favorite classic Arnold Schwarzenegger movie.
Probably the Terminator. That's probably the best one to me.
Which one? 1, 2, 3, or the last one?
1, 2, 3. Probably the third one.
Third one. All right.
Now, Max, let's say Submission Radio comes down to Hawaii and you can only take us to one place. Where do you take us?
I'll take you guys to Yokohama. Mm. Beautiful beach away from the crowd, crowded town, crowded city. It's in Waianae, all the way towards the end of the... You got on this road. It's a one-way in, one-way-out road, and you just keep driving till the road disappears, and you guys would love it.
I'm not sure if you're taking us out or trying to kidnap us, Max. No, but in all seriousness, it sounds beautiful. Finally, Max, with New Year's coming up, give us your one New Year's resolution for 2016.
One year resolution. Wear a gold strap in 2016.
Well, there you guys go. He's got some big plans for 2016. You can follow him on Twitter at BlessedMMA. Max Holloway, thank you so much for coming on Submission Radio. Have a great Christmas and New Year's, man.
Thank you so much, guys. You guys, happy holidays to you.
This is TJ Dillashaw, UFC champ. You're listening to Submission Radio.
All right, guys, our next guest is a former UFC welterweight champion. He has won KO of the Night and Fight of the Night honors 3 times each and takes on Stephen Wonderboy Thompson at UFC 196. Johny Hendricks, welcome back to Submission Radio. How are you today?
I'm doing great. How are you doing today?
Well, we're doing better now that Johny Hendricks is on the program. It's great to have you back on the show, especially seeing as we're just around the corner from Christmas and New Year's and all those celebratory occasions. How are your holidays looking, though? With a fight coming up on February 6th, will you be able to enjoy some of the festive foods, or will you be training through the holidays?
Yeah, I'll be training through the holidays. Festive foods, you know, realistically, not really. But that's what they get about the new nutrition, Lewis Nutrition, the way that he works it. I can have some of that. I just have to prep myself a different way. You know, there's a sort of a science behind all of that, and so I'll get to enjoy some food, but not all of it. But you know, some of it just makes you feel bad anyways, even though I like to feel bad sometimes. But I know that it, you know, there's an important part, the reason why I'm not doing it, and I know that's the fight and make weight and get it done.
Yeah, we feel you, Johny. We like to eat bad food until we absolutely hate ourselves. We're just food whores. But talk to us about the changes you've made in order to get your weight under control and what you're doing now to make sure you hit 170 on February 6th.
You know, sort of, you know, it's a process that Lewis goes through. And, you know, so what I got to do is I got to text every picture or text him a picture of everything I eat. Wow. And if we go out to eat somewhere, I text him the menu and he'll tell me what I can have and what I can't and what kind of proportions I need. And, it, you know, it's a lot of communication, you know, and I sort of like it. I like that I have to, you know, you sort of start even checking yourself where you're like, hey, is this good enough? Is this not? And you move forward.
Do you have any of those moments where you wake up in the middle of the night for a late night snack and he's just standing in front of the refrigerator shaking his head?
You know what? It's usually right around 1 or 2 o'clock. You're sitting there going, you know, it's about bedtime and you're sitting there going, okay, I want to get something to eat, but you got to sit there and say, okay, if I do anything, I got to text it to him. So I got to make sure that it's something he will approve of, because if not, I'll hear about it tomorrow.
Well, I'm just saying, Johny, you could always Google image something like really healthy, like super healthy food, save the image, send it to him, and then and then you know, really you could be eating something else. But in all honesty, we read that you're walking around at 196 pounds. Do you feel the difference in the gym, and are you seeing the results in your performance, not just on the scales?
You know, realistically, yes, I am seeing it on all that stuff. I am, you know, the lighter I get, the better I feel. You know, for example, I like to be walking around at 195. Whenever I'm walking around at 195, I feel ready. You know what I mean? I feel like I can I can pretty much do anything. You know, my shape is there. But now that we don't have the new IVs, I'm going to have to get it down a little bit lower. So what I'm hoping is that, you know, in the next 2 weeks, I can be at like 188, mm. you know, and do 6 weeks or 4 weeks at 188, or maybe even get a little bit lower and then start the last sort of process to get the rest of the weight off.
Mm. Well, it seemed like your future may have been at middleweight. The UFC has forced fighters to go up in weight, such as Kevin Gastelum and John Lineker recently, and Dana White stated that he didn't want to see you at 170 again. What were the talks like between you and the UFC? Did you need to convince them to let you stay at 170?
Yes, and, you know, I told him, I was like, you know, I want to be the champ again one day, and, you know, 170 is my better weight class, you know what I mean? That's where I'm the best at. Yeah, I would like to be at 185, don't get me wrong, less weight cut, but I really want to make sure that I get in there, and I sort of had to tell him, hey, I want to be at 170. I think that's the best weight class for me. And they said, we agree, but what are you going to do about it so you don't miss weight again? I said, I'll get a nutritionist. And they're like, okay, that's what we wanted to hear. And then as soon as I got the nutritionist, I let them know, hey, I got a nutritionist. And, you know, they're sort of excited about it. And, you know, I'm excited about it too, because, you know, I know how to cut weight. I know how to do all those things, but there is a science behind all that. And now it's time for me to not have to worry about that. And it's sort of nice to be down at 196 where I don't have to worry about it.
Mm. Sounds like a fairly easygoing conversation. Was there any resistance on the UFC's part at all? Were they like, sorry, Johnny, you know, we really want to see you at middleweight. And then you sort of had to go back and said, look, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to get the nutritionist. And they were like, okay. Or was it just that easy? They said, look, you've said all the right things. You're back at welterweight.
Realistically, I think I said all the right things. And I really wanted to make sure that I let them know that what my goals are, you know, and that I can get back there. And yeah, I told him, I was like, yeah, I need help. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to need that help. How do I get that help? And you go that way. And, you know, Lewis was, you know, he contacted me and, he came out, stayed with me, and I was like, man, this is going to be an awesome fit.
Mm. Do you think any part of it, the issues with the weight, had to do with the fact that you have a delicious restaurant and you could just go there anytime and have delicious meals?
Well, it wasn't even that. I think it was just, you know, I thought I had everything under control. The way that I work, and it's sort of my nemesis as well, is that if I have something that's good, I want to make it better. You know what I'm saying? And I did really good for the Matt Brown fight, but I was like, hey, if I do this, it'll be better. If I do this, it'll be better.
Mm.
And whenever I was sitting there doing that, it actually hurt me because I wasn't doing the right things to on the weight cut. You know, I wasn't combining my foods the right way. I was doing this wrong, that wrong. And, you know, that's why I need a nutritionist because, yeah, I know how to cut weight. But I want to do it healthy and I want to do it the right way where my body can handle it.
Well, you've also made some other changes since we last spoke to you, Johnny. You've left Team Takedown, which is where you spent majority of your career. Tell us about that decision and why you chose to leave.
Realistically, you know, I liked them. You know, it was just a time of the matter that I just needed to sort of break away, you know, see what I can do on my own. You know, like I said, they've treated me well. I've done the same. And realistically, it's just, you know, there's a point in your life where you're just like, you know what? Hey, can I do it on my own? You know, and I'm at that point where my contract was coming up and I was just like, you know what? Let's see if we can do it on my own.
Mm. When you spoke to MMA Junkie Radio, you did mention there were a few certain things that you guys couldn't come to an agreement on. There must have been some significant things, seeing as you decided to leave. Like you mentioned that you wanted to go on your own, but were there any other issues that you can tell us about that factored into that decision?
Not really. You know, I wish I could, but Not really. You know, it was just one of those things. Like I said, we couldn't come to agreements. And you know, at that point, you're just like, okay, hey, thank you for everything you've done. You know, thank you for helping me out. And if I wasn't, if I didn't help out back, then I would make sure that I wouldn't leave. You know what I'm saying? But since I know that we've both done our parts, we can walk away.
Okay. Here's the interesting thing. We read that you'll look to train at Oklahoma State University, majority in wrestling, and also spend time with your boxing coach. You also have at the moment, you have to find a place to train jiu-jitsu. I mean, in this day and age, it kind of seems pretty crazy. Will that be hard for you as opposed to training at one facility that has all areas covered? And are you currently looking to join a big MMA gym in the future?
You know what? Big MMA gym? Not really. I have my kickboxing coach, Stephen Wright. He's with me. Tony Cabela. And we're training at Reyes Boxing Gym there in Fort Worth. And we're training at a couple other places. And then my jiu-jitsu, excuse me, I'm actually going to be training at Genesis there in Fort Worth as well. Mm-hmm. So I have a place that I'm going to be able to train jiu-jitsu. Albert's an awesome dude. You know, he's really good. He's a really good black belt. And he's got a lot of good students in there that can push me, you know, and that's really what it's about. Definitely on the jiu-jitsu aspect, I need to make sure that I can be pushed, and those guys can do that.
Mm. It's interesting because you see all these massive teams like Jackson Winkle, John and TriStar, and AKA, and a lot of build-up is around how these amazing athletes are training with other amazing athletes. I'm just wondering, do you think you'll be able to find the same success as you would if you were in a part of a big-time gym in the long term? Or do you think that you don't really need to have a guy like Cain Velasquez to work with because there are other quality guys that just don't have name value that you can work with?
You know what? Realistically, everybody that was in my camp to get me to the belt are still in my camp. Mm. You know, that's one thing that's been nice is that I didn't need all these people. You know, I didn't have to have 60 people in one gym to get me where I need to be. You know, I got a couple of partners that have pushed me, that have done everything they could to get me to where I need to be. And they're also really good fighters, you know. It's just one of the things that, you know, for example, the guy that I train with every day, you know, his name's Razak. I see him in the UFC not too long. You know, he's an awesome fighter. He's one of the guys that pushes me, and we feed off each other. And so realistically, I think that he could be in the top 10, the way that he fights. I really do. Cause I've sparred him and I've fought a lot of guys in the top 10 and I would put him in the top 10 right now at the UFC. And he's one of my everyday training partners. So that works out really well for me.
Mm. The matchup at hand is obviously Stephen Wonderboy Thompson. You know, he's a fighter that's been on the rise for a while now, and he's facing you on a 5-fight win streak. What do you think about the matchup, though? Because he's ranked number 8, not as close a title contention as you. Is he a guy that you expect to face, or were you a bit surprised that this is the guy you're facing?
You know what? I knew that me missing weight dropped me in the rankings. You know, I was ranked number 1, and now I'm 3rd. So it is what it is. You know, every fight's dangerous. You know, definitely whenever they get in the top 10, they're definitely dangerous. They deserve to be there. And I'm looking at it as this is my rebirth. I got to come back stronger than I was. You know, I got to go back out there and prove myself that I do belong here and that my goal is still reachable, that my goal is to be the UFC champ again. And right now, he's just the next guy that I got to get through. You know, the way that I look at things and the way that I've always looked at things is I'm a nobody. I haven't done anything until you step in that octagon and you get your hand raised and you move to the next fight. But as soon as you move to the next fight, you got to forget everything in the past and then prepare like you haven't fought again. You know what I mean? You haven't fought, you haven't done anything, and you got to prove yourself every time. because as soon as you stop doing that, you lose.
Absolutely. Well, you and Tyron Woodley, which was the initial fight before he missed weight, was going to be a barn burner. People were really looking forward to it. And you guys have a rivalry that goes back to your college wrestling days. Was it tough for you not to be able to settle the score in the octagon? And is that still a fight that you want?
You know, yeah, I'd like to get that fight back. You know, I would. And I probably will. You know what I'm saying? I'm probably going to get it back. And whenever I do, we'll be able to settle it then. You know, realistically, I look at it as a blessing because, you know, yeah, it sucks that you missed weight, but the way that I'm going to rebound from this, you know, for every negative, there's a positive. And so what I've done is I've taken all the negatives and I've tried to turn them into a positive, like a nutritionist, getting everything in my life back to where I want it to be. So that way, this next run, you know, I can stay where I want to stay. You know, I thought I did that. I thought I got it back on where I wanted it to be. But, you know, the tell is pretty much that I didn't, because, you know, I wasn't able to make weight. I wasn't able to do this. Okay, why? What happened? Okay, take a step back. It's my fault. It sucks. But how do you make yourself better? You go, okay, I did it. I'm not good enough to do this on my own. Get somebody. Okay, I got that. All right, now what do I need to do? I need to do this, and get all my ducks in a row. So that way now I can really, and that's what I've been focusing on since I, you know, as soon as I missed weight, realistically, for the 2 weeks, I really couldn't train much because my body was still acting up. But as soon as I was able to start training again, I knew what I wanted to do, and I knew how I needed to start focusing on where my future lies. Mm-hmm. And that's what I needed to push. And I really can't complain where I'm at right now.
Well, looking forward and talking about this matchup with Steve Wonderboy Thompson, you know, you've fought quite a few strikers and knockouts recently in Matt Brown, Robbie Lawler, and even go back to Carlos Condit, Martin Campman. How does Stephen Thompson strike and compare to those guys? And, you know, do you think his karate style makes him the most dangerous striker you've faced?
You know what? Not, I mean, karate guys, I don't think he's the most dangerous guy I've faced. You know, do they have kicks? You know, when you're facing somebody like Carlos Condit, who can do kicks, knees, and all the above, you know what I'm saying? That's where it can get really dangerous. You know, he does have good striking. He does have good kicks. Has he been in a ring with somebody that whenever they could not put him out of the situation? You know what I mean? That can really knock him out. I have. I've been in some wars with some guys who can throw a lot of leather, right? And punch very, very hard. Mm. So that's what I'm excited to see, is whenever we go in there, do that and move forward and see how he can react. And if he can, then we'll be moving forward.
Well, like you mentioned, you've had some memorable highlight reel KOs in your resume. Do you think that you'll test your striking and power against Thompson? Or do you think you'll rely on your wrestling where you have the clear advantage? I mean, Johnny, it's pretty clear that a lot of people sort of expect you to dominate Stephen Wonderboy Thompson on the ground.
Yeah, but here's the thing. They also said that I couldn't strike with Carlos Condit. I couldn't strike with everybody was going to beat me on the feet, right? Mm-hmm. And here, I've beat everybody on the feet. You know what I'm saying? And that's what gives me even more thrill to prove everybody wrong. They're like, oh yeah, Johnny can out wrestle him. I know I can out wrestle. You know what I mean? He doesn't know the wrestling that I do. But can I out strike him? I do believe I can, because I've done it and I've proved it time and time again with really, really good strikers. So that's sort of my first MOA, is to go out there and set that precedence that I'm going to be the one that's striking. I'm going to be the one that does this. And if it has to go another way, then it has to go another way. But one thing I've realized is that now I have to focus on making sure that people know now that I can wrestle, that I have the power to wrestle again. And that's really where I wanted to make sure that, you know, that's why I say lifting weights for me is so important, because now I have the strength back to show people that I can wrestle, I can power people through, I can do everything that I want to do. That's really my goals for myself, is to do that.
A win over Thompson, Johnny, where does this put you in the division? How close do you feel you are to a title shot? Is this the win that gets you back at, you know, another shot at the belt, or do you think you may have to fight another guy, say, like Damian Maia first?
You know what? That's the thing. I might have to fight one more. I might not. It just depends what I can do with this. You know what I'm saying? This fight really is going to be the deciding factor on where I can move forward to, where I need to be. And when I can, you know, for example, too, it also depends what is it, when they fight, January 2nd, you know, or, yeah, January 2nd, Lawler and the other Carlos Condit.
I believe.
I think it's January 2nd. So January 2nd, I'm going to be fighting right after that. If I can put on a greater performance, you know, and here's the thing, too, GSP might come back. If GSP comes back, guess who wants to meet him? This guy. Yeah, you know, so there's a lot of things that can come into play by time my fight gets here. And that's really where I'm looking at is, you know, it might take two. It might take two. It might only take one fight. But I always prepare for the worst. It might take two fights, and then by the beginning of next year, I'll be able to fight for the title again. And good Lord willing, or hey, something even better. I can go out there, I can finish Wonderboy Thompson, and I can get the next title shot. You just never know.
We'll let you go in just a minute, Johnny, because we know you're a busy guy, but you mentioned GSP. We've got to ask, you know, how do you feel about this? Because rumors are swirling sort of every few weeks, every month or so, there's rumors that GSP might be returning. He's doing kind of like a test training camp, I believe, to see if he's sort of ready and willing to come back. If he does come back, let's say you sort of got the option title shot or GSP, what are you going for? Do you want to avenge that loss, or you just sort of, is it more important for you to fight for the belt?
It's more important for me to fight for the belt. You know what I mean? Because here's the thing. If GSP does come back, it's sort of funny. The rumors started happening whenever I sort of got pushed in the back, you know, and everybody thought I was going 185. You know? So realistically, the last, 2 months, the rumors started popping out. So, realistically for me, it's always the belt. You know, like I said a long time ago, the reason why I trained for GSP and I wanted all these things with him is because he had the belt. Right now, it's training for Robbie Lawler or Carlos Condit, whoever wins the next belt, wins the next match. That's all that matters for me.
It looks like, you know, if you do, things do go to plan and you do beat Steven at the beginning of the year, that fight could happen at UFC 200, you versus GSP. Would you be able to return? I mean, it's not that long of a layoff. Would you be able to return back into the octagon in July and do that if the opportunity was offered to you at UFC 200?
Yeah, I could do that. You know, that's the thing. It's like, that's one thing about doing my weight and having Lewis Nutrition on my side is that he wants me to start walking around at 195. Maybe even 190, you know what I'm saying? You know, I might be even lighter. We don't know. We're just going to see where my body sort of plateaus at and is comfortable, because what I want to do is I want to be able to take a fight on short notice.
Well, there you go. That would be crazy. From going to sort of missing weight to be able to being sort of like the company man and taking fights on short notice. Obviously, a GSP rematch is tantalizing, but in the meantime, Johnny takes on Stephen Wonderboy Thompson at UFC 196 on February 6th, and that'll be February 7th in Australia because of the time difference. Don't forget to follow Johnny on Twitter at Johny Hendricks. And as always, it's a pleasure having you on the show, Johnny. Thanks so much for your time.
Hey, thank you, and y'all have a wonderful night.
And there you guys go, Johny Hendricks on Submission Radio, the last guest for the year, technically, when it comes to fighters. It was really interesting talking to Johnny Cass. He was in the highest of highs, being UFC champion, lowest of lows quite recently. But from what he sounded like, it really seems like he's got a game plan down pat to make this weight and, you know, possibly put on his best performance against Wonderboy Thompson at UFC 196.
Yeah, I feel like Johny Hendricks is a fighter that's still sort of finding out what works for him. He's still coming into his own. I don't think we've seen Johny Hendricks in his prime yet. I don't think we've seen, you know, the best version of Johny Hendricks yet. So hopefully, you know, working with Luis Giordano and you know, doing what he's doing now and cutting out the deer meat, that's going to work well for him. And hopefully we see him, if not the champion in the future, hopefully you'll see him at least fine for the title, because I think he's, you know, he's right around the corner. He's still close.
Well, I mentioned that he was the last guest fighter on the episode for a reason. That is because we have a lot to break down in this week's episode. Like we mentioned in the intro, a lot to break down. And we couldn't finish off the year without having the next person join us, an associate editor at Bloody Elbow, who returns to Submission Radio to help us break down UFC on Fox and tell us about his latest Russian adventure. Karim Zidan, welcome back to Submission Radio, man. Welcome back to The Breakdown.
Casper, Dennis, thank you for having me on. It's a pleasure, as always, to be on the show.
Well, it's a pleasure having you. And like we said, we couldn't go and give up the end of the year episode without having you back. So it's a real pleasure having you. Jumping into the main card of bout between Randa Marcos and Karolina Kowalkiewicz. Guys, it was a decision win for Karolina. I just want to jump off first and ask you, did you agree with the decision? In my books, Marcos won the second round. Karolina won the third round. But who won the first round? I want to jump to you first, Karim. Do you think Karolina won the fight?
Oh, I'm definitely not one to bicker over close fights like this, honestly. Mm-hmm. But I personally had the fight for Kowalkiewicz, 29-28, winning the first and third rounds. But honestly, I had just stepped in early on, as soon as the fight began. I can't say that I was tuned in, ready to like to score a fight. So I'm honestly not ready to argue my case or whatnot for this specific point. But I had it for Karolina, 29-28.
Yeah, well, with great power comes great responsibility, and being the associate editor at Bloody Elbow, Karim, obviously you've got a lot of responsibilities. I think, assuming you agree with me, Dennis, and obviously we know Karim agrees, it's probably going to be a unanimous decision. I agree that Karolina won the fight. I think she was busier in the first round. I think that anytime Marcos tagged her with anything or threw any big shots, Karolina had an answer for her. So I definitely think Karolina won the first round. Marcos won the second round. Karolina, my God, I can't even pronounce my own countrywoman's name. That's the easy part. Karolina, nice and slow there, won the fight 29-28. Dennis, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree with you. And just in general, apart from the scorecard, just the fight, the movement, the footwork, I really think Karolina put on a great show. Marcos working with TriStar guys, but, and I mean, Faraz Zahabi in the corner giving her great advice, but she's still sort of a bit reckless in that octagon. I mean, running forward, chin out, sort of trying to land that haymaker punch. Mm. Do you guys think this is going to take some time for her to adopt this new TriStar mentality of mixing in some strikes and wrestling? Go to you first, Karim. What do you think? Do you think there's some potential there that Marcos just really needs to pick up?
Well, to think that Randa has basically been training with the same gym since she started at the age of 23 or in 2009, and it's going to definitely take a little while, more than just a few months, and suddenly picking up and moving to Montreal to change your style and to become a different fighter. So honestly, I didn't expect too much from her in this fight, mm-hmm. just because she has not been there long enough for us to really put a stamp on her as a fighter, to really leave a sort of a dent on her as a fighter. It just didn't make sense to me that it would happen that quickly, no matter how good of a trainer he is, really. And she was up against a really difficult opponent to game plan for, someone who was so well-rounded. So it was a matter of picking her strengths and playing to them. And of course, given that she's been doing the same thing for basically 6-7 years now, it's easy to fall back on those strengths or things that you're basically comfortable with. And I think that's sort of what we saw her do tonight.
Very wise, Karim. And I think a perfect example of that is Alistair Overeem, someone who was so dominant in the past, and then he had that rough patch, then he came over to Jackson Winklejohns, and he didn't really see the fruits of the labor until, you know, really now he seems to be coming into his own, and he's filled a lot of those holes and, you know, fixed a lot of those mistakes that he used to make. So I agree with you, Karim. That's probably similar to Randa. And I feel like a lot of her, you know, she's very tough. She's got a lot more toughness than a lot of the fighters, I believe, in the strawweight division. That's something something you can't really teach. And I think that in the future, you know, finesse will be the key for her. If she can, you know, plug those holes and fix those mistakes, she's going to be a much better fighter in the future.
Yeah, there's definitely, the tools are there. She just needs to make a connection and put it all together. Now, a fun fact for you guys, she actually worked as a pharmacy technician at a local pharmacy in Windsor. And a not so fun fact, she was actually born in Iraq, but moved to Ontario, Canada with her family when she was 3 years old. She and her family were held at gunpoint and imprisoned during the Gulf War for trying to escape. Her family managed to escape and hop on a plane for Canada. How about that? A story before she even started fighting. Crazy. I mean, that's incredibly tough. But Karim, I want to jump to you. I mean, you've had some great coverage of KSW over there in Poland. What do you think of Karolina? Do you think she has the ability to eventually become one of the top fighters in the strawweight division?
Well, I'm glad you asked that, because honestly, when she signed, I was very excited. We needed blood like her in, because to be honest, while Joanna Jędrzejczyk is the anointed queen of the strawweight division now, and she's Polish, yes, the person who really put a spotlight on women's mixed martial arts in Poland was Karolina Kowalkiewicz. That was during that KSW tournament where she won the title, that was the first time a Polish audience, a local Polish audience, actually witnessed women's mixed martial arts. And they witnessed it in the form of a young, beautiful woman who just so happened to be a really talented fighter. So her coming to the UFC as an undefeated former champion, a veteran of Invicta and whatnot, you knew that this was going to be something special. And I'm glad they put her up against such a durable, tough opponent, because it was going to be a gritty fight. It wasn't going to be a pretty fight. It wasn't going to be a showcase fight. And that wasn't something she needed. We needed to see immediately if this is someone who can jump into the deep end of the division. This is not a joke. This is not a signing that was coming in to pat someone else's record. This is someone who is supposed to challenge for the title in the near future.
Yeah, well, I mean, it was a great display by her, and we'll see what happens in the future. But like you mentioned, gritty, not pretty. I'm not sure. I guess this next fight was a bit of both. Nate Diaz versus Michael Johnson. Wow, what a fight. I mean, fight of the night for me. It was an absolutely fun fight to watch. So many great exchanges. Nate Diaz coming in what looked like the shape of his life, a six-pack there, looking great. But I want to jump on to his performance. Joe Rogan said it's the best Nate Diaz that we've seen thus far. I want to jump to you first, Karim. Do you think that we saw the best Nate Diaz in the octagon just before this weekend?
Well, honestly, I think he was in great spirit, and that's a good sign. It's always a good sign for a fighter when you see them comfortable, calm, collected, less nervous and anxious during fight week. It means they've collected their emotions, they're ready to face the challenge ahead in a different way. And that was good to see on Nate, and you could clearly see that in his movements. He seemed a little looser this time around. But in terms of his best performance, I still think his victory against Donald Cerrone a few years ago, that was the best Nate Diaz I have personally ever seen. Now, there's an argument to be made that this is the best Nate Diaz that we've seen in a long time. I mean, he just has not been himself recently, and I think the layoff actually was beneficial for him. He was always talking about nagging injuries, nothing that would take him out of a fight, but they were bad enough that they were bothering him during training and whatnot, and he wasn't at optimal just fitness and heading into fights, and that definitely affected him mentally as well. He was disgruntled, wasn't being paid what he wanted. I think the time off, I think he really missed the sport during the time off, and you could see it even with interviews with Ariel Helwani earlier this week. He was actually smiling, talking. He seemed really enjoying fight week, which is rare to say for a Diaz brother, to be honest.
I agree with you that there was definitely a vibe about him that he seemed happy to be there. It seemed like he was happy to be back, happy to be back in the spotlight. And generally, just in that whole UFC or at least, you know, fight week vibe, Nate Diaz is one of those guys where he's always come back from adversity. He has a rough patch, then he comes back. When he got manhandled by Rory McDonald, he came back and had a fantastic performance against Takanori Gomi in his lightweight return. That was possibly one of the best Nate Diaz's we've seen. Then against Donald Cerrone, I agree with you. This was probably his prime. I'm not saying that he can't get better, but this is the standout performance for me. Donald Cerrone, that was the best Diaz we saw. Afterwards, you know, we saw a great performance against Jim Miller. He lost to Benson Henderson, had a bad performance against Josh Thompson. Then he looked fantastic in destroying Gray Maynard, had a horrible performance against RDA, and now terrific performance against Michael Johnson. So I don't know if this is the best Nate Diaz we've ever seen. I think physically he looked amazing. You know, like you mentioned, Dennis, he's got the six pack. Walking out there, you know, he's always had a bit of a muffin top. He looked absolutely shredded. But I'm going with you, Karim, the best Nate Diaz that, in my opinion, I've ever seen, UFC 141, Donald Cerrone. That was pretty amazing. And not only that, Michael Johnson, he's had a lot of momentum, right? But he did technically lose to Beneil Dariush, whether you agree or not. Donald Cerrone, when they fought UFC 141, there was a title eliminator. And I think Donald Cerrone was coming in with a lot more momentum than Michael Johnson did in this fight. So, yeah, definitely against Cerrone, 141.
Yeah, it's interesting as well because Michael Johnson, I mean, it's not like he came into this fight and didn't perform. He looked great. He threw some great leg kicks. He had some good combinations. But it was just that Nate Diaz was better. And I think that's possibly why Joe Rogan was saying he's one of the best incarnations of himself. But I have to agree with you guys, that Donald Cerrone fight, I mean, he set the record for all those punches. It has to be his best performance. I mean, at the end of this fight, though, we did see Nate Diaz roll for a leg lock after the buzzer. This is at the very end of the fight. Joe Rogan complained because Michael Johnson kicked Nate Diaz, but really it was because Nate Diaz rolled for that leg lock. I want to get you guys' opinion. Do you think there should be some kind of penalty for that? Or is that one of those things that you just let go? I mean, he didn't crank on the leg. He didn't put it in. But still, it was after the buzzer. Karim, I want to go to you first. What are your thoughts? Should there be any kind of slap on the wrist for this kind of action?
It's really difficult to tell if this was more Diaz antics at the end of a fight or if it was sort of a heat of the moment thing. He didn't really notice the buzzer. He was already mid-motion somehow. He definitely held on way too long, to the point that Michael Johnson had to start kicking him. It was by no means Michael Johnson's fault. But I was watching it, and it's nothing similar to a Rusamar Paul Harris submission of some sort. So to me, I just couldn't see the malicious intent with it, if to put it, for lack of a better term, really. So I don't know whether it warrants a fine, but some sort of slap on the wrist might be necessary because, I mean, there's a buzzer for a reason. But also, the referee was really late to step in there as well. And there's something to be said about that. The official's there for a reason. It's to protect the fighters. And when a buzzer goes off, I mean, that's a clear signal to step in and, you know, separate the fighters.
Yeah. Yeah, look, I mean, the buzzer went off, and rules are rules. You have to disengage as soon as that goes off. So if Nate Diaz did get a small fine, I wouldn't be up in arms about it, you know, maybe a few thousand dollars. If it was a suspension, I think it was ridiculous, just because of the fact that, like you mentioned, Karim, he wasn't cranking. I do think it was more towards, you know, the whole Diaz antic side of thing rather than malicious intent. I don't think he was actually trying to put on the knee bar. I think he was just screwing around, which in a lot of ways is inexcusable. You shouldn't do that, but because he didn't actually put him in the lock properly, I don't think it's as bad as maybe what some people think. What do you think, Dennis?
It's one of those things. Yeah, I agree with you guys. He wasn't trying to hurt him, but yeah, a slap on the wrist, I guess, would make sense. And I agree with you, Cass. A suspension would just be ridiculous. Hopefully the commission doesn't have any negative will towards both brothers just because his surname's Diaz. But if they did call him in to testify, I don't expect him to really be talking much. So who knows? Maybe that's right. Might cost him the rest of his career. But nah, I just kid. I hope nothing bad happens from that situation. But Nate has to be careful because he's spoken about the fact that he struggled with money, with taxes, with all this kind of stuff. So, I mean, you want to try and keep as much of your purse as you can. Another controversial thing that happened was his post-fight speech where Nate Diaz lit off a bunch of F-bombs on Fox. Joe Rogan sort of looked at him like, are you crazy, man? What are you doing? It was one of those things where I don't think Nate Diaz realized that it wasn't pay-per-view, it was Fox, and it's such a big deal. Some people really loved that promo. Some people didn't, comparing him to a 15-year-old or something really basic. The children are watching. Why don't somebody please think of the children? I want to jump to you first, Karim. What did you think of that promo? Did you like it or did you not like it?
It's so hard to speak about the Diaz brother without a bias of some sort. You either hate it or you love it. There's no in between. And I can't take anyone's breakdown of a situation involving a Diaz brother seriously because there has to be some sort of bias. Personally, I've always enjoyed their antics. It's difficult. When I saw that post-fight speech, the first thing I thought was, oh, there's no way Fox is going to censor this in time. They're just not going to be able to censor this in time. And I don't know how to react to something like that. I mean, clearly someone should have given Nate the memo that, you know, you can't do this on Fox. He's used to pay-per-view, like you mentioned, Casper. But I don't know what you do with that. I mean, it's been the Diaz way for so long. I mean, his brother has missed press conferences. He had to get special liaisons to bring him in and out of the hotel to make sure they actually show up to things and whatnot. And it's they've never exactly been your average fighter. So I don't know if this situation in particular is a great way to analyze the general scene.
Yeah, no, I got you. Honestly, I forgot that it was a Fox card myself. Like, not that it was a Fox card, but I forgot that, right, you can't say those things on a Fox card as opposed to being on pay-per-view. And you say someone should have given Diaz the memo. If he's rolling for knee bars post-fight, I mean, maybe they did give him a memo. Maybe he just completely ignored it. It's very hard to tame the Diaz brothers. Look, I'm the type of person, the way I was, it's not the way I was raised. I wasn't raised to, I mean, I like to cuss like a sailor off air, but, you know, the way the Diaz brothers carry themselves. So I don't have that personal connection with the Diaz brothers, but from an entertainment aspect, I absolutely loved it. I love the realness of it. I love the rawness of it. And sometimes, you know, you get sick of people buying into that whole PR machine and sort of, you know, speaking really kindly and nice. I get that it's martial arts and stuff like that, but I feel sometimes people have different beliefs than what they actually say. With Nate Diaz, you get exactly what's on his mind. I love it. I can understand if people are upset about, you know, the fact that he was swearing on Fox, but as far as what he actually said, you know, calling Conor McGregor a motherfucker and all those things, listen, this is fighting. If they end up fighting, they're going to be punching each other in the face. CM Punk, Phil Brooks, is going to be fighting. He said something interesting, and it's been his theory for a long time. There is no such thing as offensive words, only offensive context. And I think in the context of what he said, I don't think it was offensive. So me personally, I loved it.
Yeah, I loved it too. And it was one of those situations where me and Casper, we've had so many different guests on the program. And at the end of the interview, we'll go, are you going to call someone out at the end of the fight? Are you going to try and get that title shot? And a lot of them will say, yeah, of course, I'm going to do it. Yeah, I'm going to do it. And then we watch the fight and it's like, dun, dun. They don't even ask for the fight. And you wonder, do you guys realize that this isn't just fighting? This is entertainment. And you have to build a case for yourself. And Nate Diaz... Okay, I understand it might have been children watching, and in that regard, you know, that could be upsetting for some parents. But I think even in that case, I think I like what Nate Diaz did because he went out there and he stirred the pot. He made some commotion. I mean, a lot of people are talking about this McGregor-Nate Diaz fight, and Nate Diaz is not the champion, but people want to see that fight. I think it's just a preview of what the build-up would be like if these two met up. I mean, it would be unbelievable. And Nate Diaz, he's spoken his pre-fight interviews about the fact that if he was at a press conference or something like that and McGregor said something to him, that he wouldn't take it like everybody else. I really think people want to see what would happen verbally as much as physically between these two. I think it would just be unbelievable. And I mean, that just leads me to my next question. Who do you guys want to see Nate Diaz fight next? Is it going to be that Conor McGregor fight? And if not, what fight would you like to see him at lightweight? I want to go to you first, Karim. What do you think is next for this Diaz brother?
Well, I love the points you guys just made because it's very true. It doesn't matter what our issues whether with censorship, which, by the way, I think censorship in general only enhances curiosity. So I have my own opinions about censorship anyway.
Love
so
it.
I'm not too bothered about what Nate Diaz said. But the fact that he took the microphone and immediately called out Conor McGregor, I mean, that's the stuff that highlight reels love. And when the UFC's PR team is going to start setting up all sorts of new vignettes, they're going to be using stuff like that. That's the stuff they look for, that real raw emotion. So there's no way that you can listen to that and not at least contemplate what a Nate Diaz versus Conor McGregor fight would be like. But honestly, I can't see that fight happening right now unless, say, Conor McGregor stepping up to lightweight, his opponent falls out with an injury, I see Nate Diaz stepping in as a replacement. That's the only time I can see that scenario really taking place. And then for a couple of weeks, there'll be a real exceptional hype machine going around with the verbal barrage going both ways between both of them. And that'll be something to witness for sure. It's very difficult to say where Nate Diaz lies here. He was not supposed to win this fight. He was not supposed to win this fight. It's difficult. There are many interesting opponents. Ally Quinta could be one. Dustin Poirier. I mean, he's quite low in the lightweight rankings right now. So pretty much anyone above him would be an interesting fight at the moment. It seems like there's new life in Nate Diaz.
Well, going in, he was ranked 15th. And I believe he was ranked higher before, after his win over Gray Maynard. despite the loss to RDA, but obviously the UFC took him off the rankings, so he kind of started over again in a sense. I like the matchups you mentioned. Dustin Poirier could be fun. Al Iaquinta could be fun. But I think with Nate Diaz, you got to treat him right. Not to do him any favors, but just because of the fact that it's smart for business. You like you mentioned, the highlight reels love this kind of stuff. I didn't think about Nate Diaz versus Conor McGregor. Like, obviously, yeah, you can see that matchup happening at some point. Sure, you know, it'd be fine, it'd be exciting. But just because of rankings-wise, there's no way Nate Diaz gets that fight unless Conor McGregor requests him himself, or like you mentioned, Karim, somebody gets injured. But the way that he sort of cut that promo, it definitely makes you think about it, and it definitely gives him a better chance. Obviously, winning the fight, having a great performance as well. You mentioned that he wasn't supposed to win that fight. I feel like this is supposed to be Michael Johnson showcasing himself, but instead, Nate Diaz proved, because let's be honest, Michael Johnson at one point was kind of close to sort of being in title contention. It goes to show that Nate Diaz can compete with the best at lightweight. Maybe he'll never win the next, you know, the lightweight title, but he can at least compete with the best up there. So I think give him someone like a Tony Ferguson. I was going to say Khabib Nurmagomedov, because there is beef there. They did get into that brawl. But I feel like Khabib, it'd be like Rory McDonald against Nate Diaz, but even worse. I think Khabib would have a field day with him. But you give him someone like Tony Ferguson, who, you know, does those crazy rolls. He's not afraid to go to the ground game. That would be an epic battle, you know, which possibly Nate Diaz would win on the feet. That'd be extremely exciting. But going back to what I said before about treating Nate Diaz right, you don't know how many years he has left in the sport. And because he is a draw, he does, you know, quote unquote, move the needle. You need to give him exciting matchups. If he has only, you know, five fights left, or six fights left, or four fights left, you never know when he's going to take another hiatus. So you don't want to waste him on matchups that don't really do much. Like, I don't know, him and Al Iaquinta, it may be a fun fight, but I don't see that main eventing a fight night. You need to give him matchups that matter, and possibly even get him into title contention.
Yeah, it's one of those things where I hate having to go last sometimes because Casper steals all the good points, but Tony Ferguson, I mean, could you guys imagine this Tony Ferguson fight? Casper just spoke about it, but just, okay, Tony Ferguson has been spitting fire lately on the mic, talking about how he should, talking all this stuff about Conor McGregor and all this other stuff. I mean, him versus Nate Diaz, the build-up alone, I think, would be very, very interesting. Then you go to the fight, you got this matchup of this, like you mentioned, Cass, one guy that's doing these crazy rolling knee bars and crazy strikes, and you got Nate Diaz there flipping him off, yelling things at him in between rounds. It's one of those fights that if Nate Diaz wins it, that catapults him to a possible Conor McGregor fight if Conor McGregor's become champion in the division, because it's going to boost him right up the rankings. And I agree with you, Cass. I think Nate Diaz is now at a point in his career like Nick Diaz, like Conor McGregor, where rankings don't really matter. He's more of a draw. He's like one of those exhibition type fighters in a lot of ways, where all of his fights from now on, I think the UFC will try and make interesting. Because if we give him Al Iaquinta, for example, guys, and again, Karim, this is a great fight, but imagine if Al beats Nate Diaz, then that's a lot of money lost, because people aren't going to be, you know, believing the hype as much anymore. I think you ride the Nate Diaz train as far as it goes. He's got some obvious holes in his game. He's got a wide stance that's susceptible to kicks. He can be figured out. He's not unbeatable. But while he's winning, I think the UFC gets behind him and pushes him along, because, he has a lot. I mean, a lot of really interesting stuff left for fans. And I'd love to see that Tony Ferguson fight again. I think that would be fantastic. A lot better than that Nurmagomedov fight, I think.
Well, I really hope the UFC has that same sort of vision for Nate Diaz that you guys, I guess I'm a little more jaded. I see them giving him irritating fights like that, risky fights. I guess I have no backing for that reasoning right now, but he was never exactly on the best of terms with the UFC. So I don't see why they would like to do him any favors in that regard. Well, I guess giving him someone like Tony Ferguson isn't really doing much of a favor, or Khabib Nurmagomedov at that point. But I'm not quite sure that Khabib fight would be a great one for Diaz. But if we can agree on Ferguson, that would be a fantastic one.
And just really quick, before we cut to Overeem versus JDS, we mentioned Michael Johnson. We touched him very briefly, but didn't really say much. I actually think it wasn't a horrible performance on him.
Yeah.
You know, Nate Diaz really outlasted, and he really came back in the last two rounds. But early on, Michael Johnson looked really good, and I actually found the commentary to be a bit biased.
Yes.
It was all about, you know, how amazing Nate Diaz was doing and how he was hurting Michael Johnson. And I'm not accusing Joe Rogan of anything. I'm not trying to be harsh on anyone. But from what I saw, almost every time Nate Diaz would hit Nate Diaz would hit Michael Johnson with something, Michael Johnson would come back with something. And I think with Nate Diaz, a lot of the time the volume was on his favor, but man, Michael Johnson hit him with some really, really big shots. And I just wanted to mention that in case people, you know, either forgot or didn't realize, because I actually thought, you know, Nate Diaz did win, but this is a really close fight. And when it came to the decision, you know, the way the judges are, it really wouldn't have surprised me even if they did give it to Michael Johnson. So I just felt the need to mention that.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think the commentary was biased at the start. And it's almost like one of those things when Joe Rogan and Mike Goldberg sort of get on a topic. Like at the beginning, it was, all right, Michael Johnson's going to hit Nate Diaz with kicks. So every time he landed any kind of kick, it's like, oh, that's a brutal kick. That's a terrible kick. Then Nate Diaz started taking over the fight. So then anything Nate Diaz did was sort of like to support the argument. Oh, another 1-2 from Nate Diaz. But then, like you mentioned, Cass, Michael Johnson landed some really good shots and they didn't mention it at all. So it was one of the, and then Michael Johnson landed some good leg kicks, but they didn't mention the leg kicks because they were talking about how Nate Diaz was making his comeback. And there were actually some parts in round two where I actually thought Michael Johnson was starting to take over again. And some of his striking and offense was completely ignored. So I really think that if you're listening to the commentary and watching the fight, you have a different perspective to it than if you turn the commentary off. I really thought, and I had the same mindset as you, and we haven't spoken about this up until now, but I really thought that if you turn the commentary off on the fight, you might have a bit of a different perspective, like it's a lot closer. And that's what I thought. I thought Johnson did a fantastic job. I just thought he was just a little bit off. I thought he was very, very close. What about you, Karim? Did you like Johnson's performance?
I thought it was an interesting performance in the sense that I actually believed that there was going to be a lot more wrestling involved. I assumed he was going to utilize his wrestling to somehow minimize Diaz's output in terms of striking. I just didn't see that at all. I didn't even see him attempt to go to that part of his game, which really surprised me. That was the only downside, I guess. Maybe maybe someone with better analytical experience here could really explain why maybe he wasn't able to utilize that part of his game. But if it was there and he just didn't want to use it because he wanted to knock Diaz out or outstrike him, then that's a mistake on his part. Then he was baited into Diaz's style. And that's the only thing that worries me, as I truly assumed by now he'd be a much more mature fighter than that, if that was truly the case. But other than that, on the point of the commentary, I myself wasn't listening to the commentary because generally when the fights are going, I keep it on mute anyway because I'll be typing things out at the same time. And it's quite difficult to follow Joe Rogan screaming and at the same time try and type out an article with a minimal amount of typos, etc.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, whether it was a good performance or not, it's his second loss in a row. So there you go, Michael Johnson, two losses in a row. We'll see what happens next. Now, jumping to the next fight, the heavyweight fight. This is a fight that we've been waiting for a very, very long time. Alistair Overeem versus Junior Dos Santos. I mean, who could know how this fight was going to play out? In our heads, we thought it was going to be an explosion of highlights, possibly an exciting fight. But it turned out to be quite curious. JDS did not look himself for the whole fight. A lot of people are saying that he is just not the same fighter after his most recent loss to Cain Velasquez. I want to go to you first, Karim. Why do you think we saw JDS look the way that he did today? Is it anything to do with that Cain loss? Are we just looking at a guy being cautious because he's fighting possibly, you know, one of the best strikers in the UFC, a veteran and a K-1 winner?
I think it's a mix of both. When you really think about it, it's a little more than just a loss to Cain. It's his first loss to Cain, then a long fight with Mark Hunt. Granted, yeah, sure, he did knock him out in the end, but still a long, grueling fight with Mark Hunt. Another fight with Cain, and then Stipe Miocic. That's a lot of damage to take in fights. Years off one's life, especially the Cain trilogy. My God, years off Junior Dos Santos' life. Some of the worst one-sided beatdowns in title fight history. It was incredible that he could even get up after some of that. So, honestly, it does not surprise me that his chin has become what it is now. Really, it doesn't surprise me because there's only so much the human body can take. There's only so much before you break down. He could be with a fantastic gym and whatnot. He's just not the same fighter. He doesn't move the same. He's a little more lethargic. He doesn't take punches the same way at all. And because of it, he's a lot less confident with his own shots. Did you notice how he just wasn't aggressive at all? He claimed for weeks that he was going to pressure Overeem, and the only way to beat Overeem is if you pressure him up against the wall and if you stalk him and whatnot. I didn't see much of that. Sure, he was the more offensive fighter, but that was only because all Overeem planned to do for that whole first round was counter-strike. So all I can say is that it was really not the Junior Dos Santos of old. This is not the Junior Dos Santos that knocked out Fabricio Werdum and knocked out Cain Velasquez the first time. This is a whole different fighter, and it's only natural. This is the natural progression for fighters, and especially heavyweight fighters who have taken this much beating.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, an interesting point is going to his second fight with Cain Velasquez, which marked his first loss to Cain, he was on a 10-fight win streak. Mm. Since then, he has been night and day. Absolutely, completely different fighter since that third fight with Cain. And the crazy thing is he fought Cain at the end of 2013, December 19th. He's almost been fighting once a year. Last year, we only saw him fight Stipe Miocic, and this year, he only fought Alistair Overeem. Obviously, he's not going to fight again until next year. And who knows? He may be taking, you know, a long break after this. But I agree with you. It all started in that Stipe fight. He seemed to make the exact same mistakes that he made against Cain Velasquez. He just didn't look like the same Junior. I think lethargic is probably the best way to put it. And I was amazed because I thought Junior Dos Santos, I guess I was looking at the old Junior Dos Santos, but I thought that he had this against Alistair Overeem. We saw that when Alistair does get pressured, you know, sometimes things sort of fall apart at the seams for him. And Junior Dos Santos, he used to be very good at that. You know, he left a path of destruction of the heavyweight division, you know, just, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago. And throughout that fight, there was very, very, very little offense. The only sort of glimmer of the old Junior Dos Santos we saw was when he backed Alistair Overeem up against the cage and he threw a combo. He threw some headshots, some body shots. It looked good. It looked fast. And then he backed off. And for that set, that was the only time he really pressured Alistair Overeem. And Alistair looked, I don't want to say he looked like he was in trouble, but it was the first time in the fight where he actually looked uncomfortable. Junior managed to make him uncomfortable, and then he let him off the hook, and then boom, he ended up getting knocked out. So I do feel like Junior Dos Santos has plateaued. It's hard for me to say that because you think, well, what if he goes off and what if he, you know, gets some surgeries or he rests up or he changes things up? He's changed things up. He's gone to a different training camp. He's trained with ATT. He's had multiple surgeries. And if he does take another year off, that's just another year off his fighting. And, you know, people say that as, you know, with the heavyweight division, you do have some of the most longevity. But I just think at this point in his career, he can't really, he even from a business sense, he can't take any more time off. So, unfortunately, very disappointing performance by JDS here.
It's crazy because a lot of people talk about his last fight with Cain, how much physical damage he got. But I think it's almost, guys, the mental damage that he's sort of collected from those losses. I mean, like you mentioned, Cass, he went undefeated for a really long time, and then he fought Stipe, didn't look that good. Then he had a couple of surgeries on his nose. I mean, that can't be a fun experience as well. And then, I don't know, Overeem hits him with a shot, his nose starts bleeding. Mentally, it just didn't seem like he was there. And you mentioned that part where he got Overeem up against the cage and he threw that combination. It's almost like he hit him with it. He looked at Overeem and saw that, oh, it didn't really damage him or do anything to him that I thought it would. And then he sort of backed off. Like, he doesn't believe that he's got the power like he used to. Like, before, when he used to walk into the octagon, it just seemed like he knew he was going to take someone's head off. He believed his hands had dynamite in them. But here, it's almost like he's got a real lack of confidence in himself. So I'm not sure how much of it is mental and how much of it is physical. I think it's probably a bit of both, but not sure what's next with Junior Dos Santos. I was certainly very surprised. He got Overeem in decent positions as well. Overeem was moving back nicely, but he did stumble and he didn't look that smooth sometimes moving backwards. And I thought, here we go. Junior Dos Santos is going to throw, but he just couldn't pull the trigger. It's unbelievable. It was unbelievable to watch. I mean, Overeem has his confidence back and is now on a 3-win streak in a row. Do the UFC give him an offer that he can't refuse, Karim, now that his stock is high again? Or do you let him go out there and try and get an offer from Bellator or Horizon?
Oh, there's absolutely no way they let Alistair Overeem go. But the thing is, it's just fascinating. He took a risk. He gambled on himself. He took that risk and he's about to reap the rewards. He let his contract run out and he could have easily had to renegotiate coming off a knockout loss, or even worse, coming off a snooze fest, like the fight looked like it could have been after that first round. That fight was 3 years in the making. It looked like it took 3 years to get through that first round.
Nice.
So it was difficult to watch for a while there, but everything turned around and he knocked Junior Dos Santos out in the second round, and that's just about as perfect a scenario as you'd want heading into negotiations with the UFC. He has the leverage and the momentum in his favor right now, and there's no doubt that the UFC will want to satisfy that, give him whatever it takes, a good deal, a signing bonus, whatever it may be, to ensure that he stays with them. Alistair Overeem is still a big name, and you send him out into the market, Bellator will pick him up easily, and they'll find fights for him, whether they be freak show fights or not. And if Ryzen gets their hands on them, you never know, a Fedor versus Alistair Overeem fight, the UFC can just never let such a thing happen.
Yeah, completely agree with you. And the thing is, in Bellator, he has the potential to become a champion. Who knows? He may even become a champion in the UFC. If him and Verdum rematch, you know, he's beaten him once, they're 1-1 apiece. It's possible that Overeem may be the UFC champion yet. But if he goes to Bellator, you know, the possibility of that is a lot higher. And Bellator can just keep feeding him, guys, and really build him up as this monster and really, you know, make him this massive draw. I agree with you. I think it's the last thing the UFC wants to do. And the UFC, you know, they held on to Krokop, or they signed Krokop just so that Bellator wouldn't, you know, get him. And, you know, at this point, I don't think Krokop is exactly the biggest name. You know, forget about what happened recently in the last few months, but Krokop was all but forgotten. Alistair Overeem, he's hot right now. There's no way they'll let him go, and especially in the heavyweight division, which really is the best it's ever looked, but it's still a relatively thin division.
It's funny also because his deal before, when he came in and he had that fight with Brock Lesnar, it was a huge deal. Mm. And then he sort of plateaued, mm-hmm. like you guys mentioned, and I suppose the UFC was thinking, damn, we are paying a lot of money for this guy to get beaten the way that he is back-to-back. And look how it's come around. Right at the end, he ends up being, you know, close to a title shot once again. So I definitely think they sharpened their pencil and try and get him in there. And I do think it will be a pretty big deal because me and Casper, we've had Overeem on the show a bunch of times, Karim, and I have to tell you, when he's on the program, whether he's winning, whether he's losing, we've had him on a couple of times where he sort of hasn't really been at the top of his game. People still want to listen. People are obsessed with this guy. I don't know what it is. I mean, when people say Overeem, people want to check him out. They want to watch him. They want to tweet about him. They want to see what's happening next. So I do think that Ryzen and Bellator would offer him a huge deal. I think UFC will definitely keep him around. But that leads me to the next question. Who do you think Overeem gets next? Do you think he does get a title shot against the winner of Kane versus Verdum? Karim, what do you reckon?
Just like you were talking about the importance of treating Nate Diaz right, and the UFC needs to put him in correct matchups, I think you need to handle Overeem wisely, because look what happened last time. You never know when he's going to be put into a fight that he's going to lose at this point. Although he does look fantastic, he's getting better with each fight, and the impact of being a Jackson Winklejohn's clearly showing on him. Mm. I think the safest option is to set him up with the winner of Verdum Velasquez. I think that has to be the fight you're looking for, because it sells one way or another. A fight with Velasquez would sell if he's champion, and a fight with Verdum, that's an easy trilogy with a whole new layer to the story. It's just so incredible. They'll have fought in three different promotions, three different storylines each time. It's just a fantastic trilogy. It's exactly the sort of trilogy you want to set up, not a fabricated one that's clearly set up to make some quick money. This is something that a natural trajectory for both fights, and they just happen to intersect once again. It will be a great finish, and to see if Fabricio Verdum can really actually beat Alistair Overeem, because that second fight was terrible between them. But to see how Verdum has developed and what's happened to Overeem since then, because he was believed to be, I mean, Uberim, the indestructible at the time when he was Strikeforce champion and coming into the UFC, and then he destroys Brock Lesnar and sends him into retirement. And I mean, his streak couldn't have been better. I mean, he couldn't have looked better at the time. But all that's changed. So I think the UFC should just hold on to him for now and wait and see what happens in the Fabricio Verdum Cain Velasquez title fight.
And on the flip side, if Cain Velasquez does beat Fabricio Verdum and it ends up being Overeem versus Velasquez, there's a great story there as well. I remember back in the day before Overeem, not before he was in the UFC. Actually, yeah, when Strikeforce was first bought, people were making posters, fans were making posters on MMA forums about Cain Velasquez versus Overeem. And I think there's still a lot of interest in a fight like that. And I think if Cain Velasquez does beat Verdum, let's say he beats Overeem, that shoots him right back up, and he gets a lot of momentum back from that devastating loss against Verdum. if Overeem beats Cain Velasquez after Cain Velasquez beats Verdum, that's an immense amount of momentum. I mean, a lot of people, you know, talk about C-level Cain Velasquez and, you know, altitude Cain Velasquez, but if he does beat Verdum, I think a lot of people say, all right, Cain's back, he's as good as he always was. That's, you know, the Verdum fight was a small hiccup. In comes Overeem. Let's say he beats Cain Velasquez. People are going to be like, wow, Overeem is really back. He's a changed man. He's finally living up to his potential. You know, and if it goes the other way, if Cain Velasquez does dispatch of Overeem, again, a lot of momentum back for Cain Velasquez's favor. But I agree with what you said, Karim, in the sense that you never know when Overeem is going to have one of those performances. You never know if he's going to get a little too confident, he's going to have a fight that he's winning, and he ends up somehow losing it. This is probably, if he doesn't win the title, this is probably his last chance at an actual title run and at possibly being in title contention. So I definitely think do the safe thing. Like I said, I thought Junior Dos Santos has beat him. There was a few fights where he could have lost. So give him a title shot while he's still on top.
I'm going to disappoint a lot of Australian fans listening right now who are hoping to see Mark Hunt fight Overeem as the main event at UFC Brisbane in March.
Yeah.
By saying, I don't think the UFC are going to do it. I agree with you guys. You give him the path of least resistance and you make sure that you cash in on the fact that his stock is high. Why pay a guy a ridiculous contract if you're not going to be able to make money off him in that big matchup? And I wouldn't risk putting him up against Mark Hunt. I wouldn't risk putting him up against Stipe or even Arlovsky if Arlovsky beats Stipe, because that would be very, very dangerous, and then you lose your investment. So, yeah, I definitely think the title fight makes sense. It would be a really fun build-up where Overeem isn't very impressed by anything or anyone and does his unimpressed face for the whole countdown. And, I mean, Verdum, I'd love to see what he looks like now if they do get matched up. Velasquez, I mean, who knows? Who knows what's going to happen in that fight between Verdum and Velasquez? But if Velasquez does fight him, be very interested to see. Will he take him down? What's going to happen on the ground? And obviously, Overeem's got that fantastic team of Jackson Winklejohn behind him. So very interested to see what happens next. But no doubt about it, hopefully the UFC is able to keep him around. Now, guys, jumping to the main event, Donald Cerrone versus Rafael Dos Anjos. It was a fight, the second fight, but it was a fight that was very, very quick. RDA comes out, guns blazing, beats Cerrone in the first round via TKO. I mean, I thought RDA would beat Cerrone, but not like that. Karim, your impressions of the fight?
Well, I was a little disappointed of Cerrone, to be honest. I'm not quite sure what happened to him. Did he look like he stopped? He asked the referee to stop the fight. I can't tell what exactly happened at that stoppage. It looked a little premature, but I mean, slightly premature. In replay, it seemed fair, but I couldn't tell if he seemed okay with the stoppage, if he was disappointed it was too soon. I really couldn't tell if he got injured in the fight, he broke his rib, whatever happened. But something happened, and it was just a disappointing showing overall. He got bulldozed in that fight, and it was terrible. It was worse than his first fight against RDA. And it really puts into question every single time Donald Cerrone is put into the spotlight and put into a situation where it's your time to shine, he fails to live up to it. And it's just disappointing to see every time around. On the flip side, Rafael Dos Anjos like really, really made an emphatic statement tonight. He really did. I mean, coming off the win against Anthony Pettis, who many had claimed that was going to be in the next special UFC star, he destroyed him over five rounds, and that wasn't enough to be respected as champion. Comes in, beats Donald Cerrone quickly, and it just was without even blinking. And let's see fans now try and analyze this and determine how Rafael Dos Anjos is not a worthy champion at lightweight. It just doesn't make sense. Are we going to talk about USADA testing? Are we going to make up all these reasons? Oh, great, he looked leaner. Did it make any difference whatsoever come fight night? Not in the slightest.
Yeah, it's crazy. You know, obviously Cowboy Cerrone coming in there on an 8-fight win streak. Some of those guys being Evan Dunham, Adriano Martinez, Edson Barbosa, Jim Miller, Eddie Alvarez, Miles Jury, Benson Henderson, and John McDessie. All guys who not only couldn't beat Cerrone, none of these guys managed to make much of a statement against Cerrone. Rafael Dos Anjos beat him in 66 seconds. That's crazy. And it's crazy that he beat him even faster than the first fight. A lot of people were picking Cerrone going into this fight, saying that he's a changed man. He's got so much momentum. And clearly, none of that momentum really meant anything. And it was the body kicks that really dismantled Cerrone. There was a knee to the body, and there was also the left kick to the body that RDA landed on him multiple times in their first fight. So I was a little bit surprised, and much like you, Karim, I was a bit disappointed that happened so early in the fight. It just seemed like I don't necessarily want to say that Cowboy Cerrone didn't make the necessary adjustments, just because maybe he did, and maybe in his mind he was ready to go, but he has been a notoriously slow starter. So it could be that had that fight gone a little bit longer, maybe if it dragged out to the second, third rounds, maybe Cerrone would have made a comeback. But considering how the first fight went and how this fight went, there was really nothing to, you know, nothing indicative of that happening. So incredibly impressed with Rafael Dos Anjos. He just made a massive statement, and then calling out McGregor afterwards was just the icing on the cake. I feel like he's almost in a Chris Weidman position where he needs to tell people, get on the team before it's too late. Although that's a funny example considering that Weidman lost. But nevertheless, for a long time he was beating people. Chris Weidman was, and people just didn't give him the respect. Rafael has just made statement after statement, you know, from even before when he destroyed Anthony Pettis, to even before that when he destroyed Benson Henderson. So, yeah, this guy's without a doubt for real.
Maybe they can jump off Weidman's team onto his team now that Weidman's lost. Looking for a new team to jump on. Hey, come on here. Come on my team. But it was one of those things. I agree with you guys. It was super impressive, but I was super disappointed because I wanted to see a longer fight. I wanted to see the war. I was really looking forward to it. Obviously, Cerrone has that tragic story with his grandmother going into the fight. You really just wanted to see one of those crazy fights back and forth. But I guess that's what happens. I mean, Cerrone spoke a lot of shit about RDA leading into this fight. And RDA just sort of went out there and beat the crap out of him. And like you mentioned, Cass, in 66 seconds, that's the ultimate statement. You mentioned that he called out McGregor in his post-fight speech. What do you guys think? Does McGregor versus RDA make sense for the next fight? If not, if he doesn't get McGregor, is there anyone else in the lightweight division you'd like to see him fight instead? Karim, I'll go to you first.
Well, it's interesting because everyone seems to think that McGregor should fight Frankie Edgar next, or that's the fight that the UFC is going to book because it makes more money. I think McGregor has a lot more leverage than people might imagine. And if he is adamant that he wants to collect the lightweight title next, I don't see any way that the UFC is not going to give him that shot. If he wants to fight Rafael Dos Anjos next, he'll get that fight. I truly believe that. If he wants to stay, wait a little while and fight Frankie Edgar first, that'll be the fight that comes up next. But honestly, the ball is in Conor McGregor's court right now. And that is exactly what it has to play out, depending on how he analyzes the situation, whether he's going to go for that title shot next, title opportunity at lightweight, or whether he's going to stay in his division for a little while. So I don't really think it's Rafael Dos Anjos' choice. But if not, I really think the fight that he should get next is Khabib Nurmagomedov. That's the fight that he needs to avenge to really cement his championship run. That's the only person who's really put a beat down on Rafael Dos Anjos recently, and not even very recently, but that's the fight that everyone questions. That is there another fighter in the division who should be the actual champion and just so happens to be injured, and that's the reason he's not champion? It's sort of a Daniel Cormier, John Jones thing, but on a lighter level, on a smaller scale. So that's definitely the fight that the UFC should book. I'm just not sure that Khabib Nurmagomedov should take that fight immediately coming back from a two-year layoff at this point. 2 years? Is it going to be 2 years or longer now? I'm not quite sure. But
April 19th of 2014.
Yeah, see, like, so it's been a long time. I'm not quite sure coming back from that long a break and a layoff is a good idea to jump into a title fight. So it's going to be an interesting thing to see. Maybe Tony Ferguson gets it. I'm not quite sure what's going to happen next, to be honest.
Yeah, I love your points, and I love the comparisons to sort of John Jones and Daniel Cormier, and I agree that if he does beat Khabib Nurmagomedov, it's kind of like open and shut case. You can't really take anything away from Rafael Dos Anjos. But again, like we mentioned, April 19th, 2014, that's the last time Khabib Nurmagomedov fought. It was against Rafael Dos Anjos. He has not taken any fights since, and by the time they book that fight, if they book that fight at all, it's probably going to be after April or maybe around there. So it'll be around about 2 years on the nose. And I agree that Rafael Dos Anjos, he should probably take a tune-up fight. I think he's a little bit, I don't want to use the word rudely and say irrelevant, but just as far as the title picture, even though he is ranked high, I think a lot of fans may have forgotten about him. And I think he needs to get in there and really remind, you know, the UFC fans who he is. The hardcore fans know who he is, but I really think he needs a tune-up fight. And if you don't give him Khabib, I don't think there really is anyone else. Anthony Pettis is still ranked number one. He's facing Eddie Alvarez. I don't know. Do you really give him the winner? It's not something that I would be that excited about. Eddie Alvarez, who recently lost to Donald Cowboy Cerrone. Anthony Pettis, who recently lost to RDA. And then if you're going down to Tony Ferguson, I think that guy's right around the corner from a title shot, but I do think he needs one more. He's ranked number fifth. So as we sort of break it down, it's interesting that the most exciting option for the lightweight division is the featherweight champion, Conor McGregor. So it really depends what he's going to do. If he does want to fight Frankie Edgar, and people say if he fights Frankie Edgar and beats Frankie Edgar, he's going to clean out the division, featherweight that is, and then move on to lightweight and then continue to journey, you know, that's a possibility. But if he does come to lightweight and fight Rafael Dos Anjos, you know, that's a big money fight, you know. The potential of holding two titles at the same time, or at least, you know, if the UFC forces him to vacate the featherweight title, at least, you know, hold two titles in the UFC, not simultaneously, but, you know, still be a dual division champion. But the other thing is, if you do give him Frankie Edgar, Conor McGregor that is, there's a possibility that Conor will lose. You know, and if he does lose, then you're missing out on a big title fight, potentially with Rafael Dos Anjos. And I think there's a lot less to lose if Conor let's say hypothetically Conor loses to Rafael Dos Anjos. You've got that excuse that, well, look, he was fighting above his division. Yes, he wants to fight at lightweight eventually, but he was going up and fighting, you know, someone who's on an incredible amount of momentum. So I do think RDA versus Conor McGregor is the fight to make now, and then worry about the featherweight division later on.
And it's one of those things as well where you almost, in a way, want McGregor to become lightweight champion, because it's interesting. You guys are talking about who would fight RDA next, and you look at the lightweight division, and even though it seemed like it was packed, it's not actually that packed anymore, and there's not that many big stars coming up apart from Tony Ferguson. And like you mentioned, Cass, I don't know that many people are going to be interested in seeing an Anthony Pettis rematch if Anthony beats Eddie Alvarez. Mm. So but having Conor McGregor become champion and lightweight, all of a sudden, it's interesting again. You got guys in the division that could possibly fight him that would make great matchups. Whereas with RDA, he's been in the division for so long. He's fought so many people. And in the division, there's so many sort of bigger names coming off losses that you don't know who to put up against him apart from Khabib. So it'd be very interesting to see if McGregor can get that title shot and become champion, because I think it would invigorate the division quite a bit. But let me ask you guys, Donald Cerrone, he's lost to RDA twice. He's fought a whole bunch of guys. What do you think he does next? What's his role in the division now? I'm going to go to you, Karim. What do you think happens with the Cowboy?
It's interesting, you know. Come to think of it, why couldn't he be Khabib's tune-up fight? I'm not sure. Maybe that's an interesting one right there. I mean, I don't know. That's just coming off the top of my head. But they have a bit of a heated rivalry between them, back and forth, Twitter spat and whatnot that I think happened earlier in the year, and they were supposed to fight time and time again, and it never happened. So I think that would be a fantastic fight, come to think of it.
Mm. Can I just jump in and ask you, though, is the UFC going to put themselves at a risk? I mean, Khabib is a very good fighter, but what if Cerrone beats him? He can't do a third RDA fight, especially so soon.
Well, I think at this point, any fight for Khabib is going to be a risk coming back from the light, unless you give him a walkover opponent, which is not really going to entice anyone come a title fight. Like you were just trying to say that the UFC would want to build him up again because maybe the UFC fans or casual fans have forgotten about Khabib, which makes perfect sense. I mean, a guy steps out for 2 years, a lot can happen in the UFC in 2 years. I mean, we look at it, the picture was going around about the champions back in 2013, and you look at the picture now, not a single one of them is still champion, and that's incredible. So a lot happens over 2 years, and MMA fans are very fickle when it comes to these things. So I wouldn't be surprised if Khabib is not a name that comes up easily. So he needs a big fight. He needs an important fight. And people seem to resonate with Donald Cerrone. So if he puts a beating on Donald Cerrone, that's an emphatic statement. That's something that sets up a title fight.
Mm. Yeah, it's one of those things. Or maybe the winner of Anthony Pettis, Eddie Alvarez. Because
that's another one, yeah.
There, if he does get beaten, at least you can still get that person to fight RDA. What do you think, Cass?
Yeah, either way, you've got rematches. Either way, you've got Anthony Pettis against Cerrone again, or you've got Eddie Alvarez versus Cerrone again, which just recently happened. So I'd rather see something fresh. I'm a bit sick of these rematches. Look, Khabib Nurmagomedov versus Donald Cerrone. Kareem, I think you've sold me on it. It was the fight that was set up at one point. I think twice, even. I think UFC 187, John McDessie stepped in. Pretty sure that was last minute, and then there was another time where it was set up. So, you know, make the fight that was good enough at one point. I think it's still good. If you don't do that, because I have this feeling that the UFC likes Cowboy, and I have a feeling they would like them as their, like, sorry, I have a feeling they would like him as their champion. He's a very marketable guy. So I think they want to keep him around that title picture. You give him a guy like Khabib, you know, if Cerrone beats him, let's say RDA versus McGregor happens. Let's say McGregor wins. You can do Cerrone versus McGregor. There's beef there already. If Khabib wins, you know, boom, give him a title shot against either McGregor or Rafael Dos Anjos. If you don't do that, if you don't keep Cerrone up at the title picture, then you have to restart with him. You have to give him, I don't know, guys sort of around the lower top 10 or lower top 15, do, and I guess keep him happy, which is basically fighting, you know, every 2 weeks, regardless of who the opponent is, so we can, you know, make those bonuses. And obviously, if you stick Cowboy on any card, that adds excitement. So you could always take that route as well.
Do you guys think that maybe a Nate Diaz-Khabib fight might be good? Or do you think, nah? Because in that case, if Nate Diaz does somehow beat Khabib, then it sort of catapults him up there to a potential title shot, a potential fight with Conor McGregor. And if Khabib beats Nate Diaz, then that gives him that big boost. Everybody will watch the fight and everybody will be psyched to see him have a title shot.
I think that's another great fight to set up, but I also think that's a lopsided fight. I just can't see how Nate Diaz would win the fight. But again, anything can happen at this point. We've seen some incredible upsets this year, so I think it's time to stop talking about fights like anything is guaranteed.
Yeah.
So I'd take that fight. I'd take any of them, to be honest. At this point, I want to see Khabib in a good fight, a reasonable fight, a fair fight, to see him catapulted back into the title picture somehow, because it's do or die at this point. He's getting older. It's 2 years out of the game. You never know what... I mean, fighters sometimes don't ever come back the same after such injuries. Yes, well, technological advancements have made things very different, and people can come back from ACL injuries and whatnot a lot better. But it's the mental side that's really something we got to question. Khabib has taken a lot of injury to the point that he even contemplated retirement.
Mm.
That's not an easy thing. That's not an easy thing to think about. I'm not saying that he was beaten or defeated as a human being, but he was that disgruntled or that upset with the situation, and that it takes a toll on a human being. It takes a toll on one's body, on one's motivation, on one's willingness to go into the gym every day and put in their best effort, or even at one point to fight at their best because they're worried about more injuries later on. So it's just a tough situation for Khabib right now.
I think there's more fun matchups for Nate Diaz than Khabib Nurmagomedov. Like I mentioned before, you know, when Rory McDonald manhandled Nate Diaz, I think against Khabib, it'll either be similar or worse. I don't think that's a very winnable fight for Nate Diaz. Like you mentioned, Kareem, obviously nothing's guaranteed. Obviously, Nate, in theory, wasn't supposed to win against Michael Johnson. But yeah, I think that would take a lot of the steam out of Nate Diaz. I think Cerrone versus Khabib, you know, Cerrone's lost a lot of steam anyway, so I don't think it would hurt him as much. And Khabib really needs a big win if he's going to challenge for the title, which, you know, in some ways, you can say he's irrelevant, but in other ways, he is very relevant. You know, he's irrelevant in the sense that he was out for 2 years, but he's still ranked number 3. He just needs a reminder to everybody that, you know, he's still here and he deserves that next title shot. So I wouldn't want to see Nate Diaz versus Khabib Nurmagomedov, to be honest. Not at this point, anyway.
Well, one will wonder if they use that fight that the Diaz boys had against the Khabib team at World Series of Fighting as part of the build-up of that fight ever happened. But guys, there you go. That was the event. It was very, very interesting. Now, Karim, we were talking about commentating and Joe Rogan and Mike Goldberg, but you yourself had a bit of a commentating journey to Russia to commentate M1 Challenge 63 in St. Petersburg. We want to ask you, we've seen a whole bunch of commentary. We've spoken to a whole bunch of commentators who had the voice on the show recently. What's it like commentating on these M1 events? And what are some of the harder aspects of doing these kinds of broadcasts for you?
Well, I think the very first time I did the commentary, it was sprung up on me. I was there. First of all, I was in Russia visiting friends and whatnot. It was my first time in Russia. That happened exactly a year ago this weekend, believe it or not. So it's been a year since my first commentary gig with M1. And they sprung it up on me right after an interview with Vadim Finkelstein. As soon as the interview was over, he asked the PR lady, Daria, to actually translate for him that he liked my English and wanted me in the commentary booth the next day because their actual commentators were absent for this event, that they were not going to be able to make it because of the holidays, basically. So I had less than 24 hours. I accepted the role. I said, sure, why not? This is going to be an experience one way or another. I'm in a foreign land. So trying to do it on 24 hours notice was daunting in itself. So since then, every trip I've done 3 trips since then, each one for commentary specifically. Every time I go in, I'm preparing and I'm doing my notes and whatnot. I remember that first time where I had no notes. I had less than 24 hours to learn how to pronounce those Russian names and learn everything and deal with a commentary partner I've never spoken to before, whose main language is Russian. and it was a very interesting experience. So every time I look back on that, if I'm ever worried, I smile and I think, yeah, it can't ever be like that again. I'm gonna be fine. So it's just learning to go with the flow. I work with Ian Freeman, who's a former UFC fighter, beat Frank Mir back in the day. A lot of casual UFC fans now will definitely not know who he is, but definitely a pioneer for British MMA and quite a character. So working with him is a blast, and it's an honor, and it's an experience because I learn from him more every day. His play-by-play is fantastic, since he's clearly an experienced person. All I provide is color. So I do my research, I do my notes, and I sit down and I prepare myself, and I watch tape for different fighters, and I try and paint a picture for the fight as it's happening. And it's just an interesting experience trying to work with a partner and fitting in chemistry, and doing it in a foreign land adds a whole new layer to it. So the more I learn about Russia, the more stories I have to tell during the fights and whatnot. As it makes a big difference. Before, when I'd look at the fight card and I'd see fighters from a different region, I couldn't really tell what was what. Now when I actually look at a fight card, for instance, in this last trip to St. Petersburg, when someone is from Ingushetia, the Republic of Ingushetia, I know exactly what that is, who the president is, what goes on in that region, what it's close to, what their training is like there, what their altitude is. I have a lot more information just from experience of doing Russian MMA events. So it gets easier and easier with each show, to be honest.
And I feel like you're our connection, not just us personally, but MMA fans in general, because, you know, a lot of these fantastic fighters are coming out from that, you know, European and Russian region and places like, you know, Dagestan and places like that. And no one really covers this, not anyone really English speaking, you know, not really any of the major outlets. But you, obviously being associate editor for Bloody Elbow, we get updates on KSW and what's happening in that region all the time, which is fantastic. You always do these long form pieces, the MMA Diaries, which have multiple parts. We know that the MMA Diaries on this trip hasn't come out yet on Bloody Elbow, but do you have any crazy experiences from this trip you can share with us?
Well, this trip actually was a lot calmer than usual. The team was winding down, so there weren't any adventures. I didn't get to go out with anyone from M1 around to experience things, and I did get sick at the end of the trip. But I did go out to adventure around the city because I got bored one evening, and I thought, okay, I don't have much work to do now. All the fighters have just finished cutting weight, so I'm not going to find anyone who's going to want to walk around St. Petersburg with me in this little, like, rainy day. It was quite warm, but it was rainy. So I just left on my own, walked around, walked up 4 kilometers to the main tourist area, walked back, and all I had with me was some music. And then I realized that my regular playlist wasn't even on my phone because I usually have an iPod and an iPhone, and the iPod had the music. I only had the iPhone. So all I had was some Biggie and Tupac. And nice. That's what I was listening to while I was walking down the streets in St. Petersburg. So it was quite an experience listening to Tupac while walking down Russian streets. So, and in terms of things going on, that was probably all I really did that was very different in this event. It was nothing like, for instance, Sochi, where I got to go swim in the Black Sea and climb up the Olympic rings before boarding a plane and doing all sorts of different interesting things like that due to a little bit of intoxication. But it's very different going to events as a commentator versus as a journalist, where you have to maintain some sort of professionalism. After an event as a commentator, I get to enjoy myself with the team and whatnot and go out. I can have a few drinks and whatnot and let loose. So it's a very different experience, and I actually enjoy it that way. And what I don't like, though, for instance, is taking short plane rides. I'll tell you what, you guys, I think, already know how much I dislike air travel.
Yeah.
You put me on a big jumbo jet and I already don't like it. I'm already, even though you barely feel the travel when it's in the air. Now, if you put me in a tiny little jet with no more than 10 rows and 2 seats on each side to take me from Helsinki to St. Petersburg, and I'm going to be petrified. I'm telling you, this didn't even have wind turbines. It had, what were they called, those propellers at the front of the plane. So I'm sitting there at my window seat looking out at these propellers as they're slowly building up speed, and I'm thinking, I'm going to die today. This is just going to stop moving and it's just going to fall. It was a hell of a flight. I can't imagine how people travel on private jets and whatnot on these smaller size planes because, ooh, you really feel every bump. So, yeah, that's about it from that trip, to be honest.
I could just imagine Kareem sitting there like a scene from Saving Private Ryan listening to Changes. As the plane gets higher and higher. But that's awesome, Karim. Now, speaking of Russian MMA, I mean, We sort of briefly touched on this earlier when we were talking about Overeem, but Fedor will be making his big return at Ryzen, and we waited for the opponent to be announced. We waited, we waited, we heard some opponents, then we waited some more, only to find out it's actually going to be Jaideep Singh, who was said to fight him earlier on all along. I mean, what's going on? I know you wrote a bit of an article on this. Do you think this was the opponent that the Ryzen was waiting to announce, or do you think things just didn't work out and they just went with Deep at the end?
So I asked a couple of sources about this, and from what I gathered, Jaideep Singh was the original opponent. So when Ariel Helwani originally announced that opponent, that was exactly the fight that was planned. When Saki Kabara came out and said that I am going to select an opponent who will be significant to the future of MMA, that's a direct quote, by the way. That was the opponent he had in mind. Now, the initial negative reaction led them to seek out opponents like, if I'm not mistaken, Randy Couture was actually one of the names that was mentioned, but he did not take the fight, mainly because apparently his body just couldn't take it. He tried to start training and his body couldn't take it. I'm not even sure what his UFC contract limitations are. I didn't get to ask about that part, but I know that they were looking into Randy Couture and a few other names, but everything fell through. And so once they realized that their plan B's and plan C's weren't working, they put Jaideep Singh into a title fight at Deep for his second fight, just so that they could build up his name and give him some sort of relevancy and say, well, look, Fedor is challenging a Japanese champion, and like a Japanese promotions champion. So that was sort of the goal, and they did that. He won, and voila, you have Fedor versus Jaideep Singh.
There you go. Well, Jaideep Singh, for those who don't know, he's 2-0 in MMA. He's undefeated. He's obviously got an extensive kickboxing record, fought a lot in K1. His last three kickboxing fights ended in losses. That's going all the way back to 2014. I'm just going to say, you know, I'm disappointed as an MMA fan, because the complaints with Fedor has always been the level of competition. And when we spoke to Vadim Finkelstein and everyone in the news and everyone who's been saying anything about Fedor, any close sources have always been saying that Fedor's coming back and he wants to fight the best competition. He can go to the UFC and fight the best competition and things like that. So for it to eventuate, regardless of what happened, I can understand, obviously, in the fight game, a lot of things fall through all the time. But, you know, for him to come back and fight a guy like Jaideep Singh, who's had two MMA fights, and Fedor for a long time was, you know, thought of as the best heavyweight in the world, and many people still think that, it's very disappointing. That's probably the best way that I can explain it.
Yeah, and Karim, I'm just wondering, what do you think? Do you think that this matchup, like what Casper said, might turn a lot of fans off from watching Ryzen? Because I have exactly the same thoughts as Casper does. I mean, I was really excited to see Fedor return. But now I'm sort of like, yeah, I'll catch the fight, but will I be trying to watch it live? No, probably not, because it's really irrelevant when it comes to MMA and the scene right now. Do you think it turns off a lot of fans from watching Ryzen?
See, it depends if you gauge your opinion on fans or fan perspective based on Twitter or not Twitter. Because if it's based simply on Twitter, then we're talking about a select portion of the fan base that is dedicated enough to watch sports and at the same time tweet about them and create a sort of community online, which is really, we're talking about a minute percentage of a fan base or a population in general. So I don't like to gauge perspective based on Twitter, which was, by the way, extremely negative when the announcement was made, and rightfully so. I understand that. But to be honest, I have since published multiple articles on Fedor, whether it be on Jaideep, his coach saying that he could knock Fedor out in a single blow and whatnot. And all of those articles, they're attracting the traffic, a lot of traffic, to the point that those posts are at the top of the network right now. So whether people are saying they're not going to watch it, no matter what, I find very interesting is fans keep complaining, yet they keep clicking on articles, just the same way as they keep complaining, but they're going to click on the video, or they're going to switch on Spike, or they're going to wake up early and watch it, because that's what they do, because people will complain, but that doesn't change the end result. At the end, but here's the problem. You're watching, but that doesn't mean you've got them engaged. They could be very bitter about this specific fight. Everyone's going to think, well, this could have been something special. But to be honest with you, as much as I was one of the ones who was doing a lot of the reporting and giving out a lot of updates regarding Fedor's negotiations with the UFC, while they seemed encouraging for a long time, I truly didn't believe that he was going to sign with them. I truly didn't. There's a, the still waters run deep. And in this regard, he really, really, really has a big problem with Dana White and the UFC. And it came out, he recently called their contracts enslaving and oppressive. And those aren't light words at all. That's exactly what he thinks about the promotion, how they handle people. He thinks he gets no respect. This is very real. These are emotions and feelings he's carried about from the UFC for years now. So it wasn't going to change overnight. When I spoke to many different people in Russia who are directly associated with Fedor, everything they would say is, well, we didn't like this when we saw this, or we didn't like this from them, or this or that. They expect very different. When they're treated, if you see the way a Bellator treats them, or a Ryzen treats them, or what, they treat them like kings. And then come along the UFC saying, well, you're just like everyone else. We're going to offer you this. You come for us. You belong to us for the next few years. Sign or, you know what, go to hell. It doesn't really work that way. You can't offer him a half-ass deal and expect him to sign it because he wants to fight in the UFC. Fedor coming back and saying he wants to fight the best was a typical PR statement that would come. What did people exactly expect when a guy announces that he's coming out of retirement? Oh, I'm just coming back to make a few bucks off you viewing me a couple of times and I'm leaving again. This is totally visual clickbait, guys. Bye-bye. Like, no, it doesn't make sense. What did anybody expect here? He was going to come back and he was going to shop around, find the best deal he could, which he did, by the way, multi-million dollar deal, which the UFC was just simply not going to give him. And he got that deal and he's going to fight easy fights to make that money. He's not even a 40-year-old man yet. Do you think he doesn't want to set up a nest egg or a savings for the future? Situation's getting rough in Russia right now. You never know what happens. Making some money right now off a few more fights over the next few years, that's definitely a good idea. It's good business on his part. The deal and the negotiation was fine, but in terms of as a fan, yes, I am disappointed. But at the same time, I don't have high expectations for the Fedor we're going to see. So I don't want to see him in dangerous fights. No, I don't want to see him against a Cain Velasquez or an Alistair Overeem. I don't want to see him against fighters who have been fighting for the last few years and who are proven and who are still elite fighters and who are younger than him. I don't want to see that because we're going to see what happened in Strikeforce all over again, even if TRT is not an option right now. We're not going to see the best Fedor. He's not going to come back from 3 years, train a little bit in Russia under the same conditions he's always trained under, not changing anything. It's a zebra who never changed his stripes. It's just never, nothing's changed at all. He's training in Moscow. He went for a little bit in the Netherlands. This is exactly the same structure he's always had, surrounded himself by the same Russian heavyweights who aren't even elite fighters right now. I mean, what are we expecting of Fedor, really? This is a novelty that we're seeing. And we might as well just witness him fight, whatever the result may be.
Well, there you guys. As a Fedor fan, I am super deflated and I'm going to go cry right now. No, Karim, that's a fantastic perspective. And you mentioned those articles, guys. Make sure to check out Karim's articles. He's an associate editor on Bloody Elbow, which is obviously one of the best websites in MMA. His articles, and we have to tell you, Karim, and this is partly why we wanted to get you on the show, your articles are really great, man. And we, guys, like we mentioned, he covers everything when it comes to MMA, not just the UFC, not just Bellator, but he goes out, he goes to these events in Europe and he covers them for you. So keep an eye out on his articles and also follow him on Twitter at Zidan Sports. Karim, thank you so much for coming onto our program. And guys, we'll be right back right after this short break.
Hey guys, this is Chad Money Mendez and you're listening to Submission Radio.
And there you have it, guys. Karim Zidan, off he goes, associate editor from Bloody Elbow. Absolutely love having that guy on the show. We were actually meant to have him on quite a few times to discuss his Russian adventures, but because he's, well, in the midst of Russian adventures, sometimes it can be a bit hard to get the man on. But expect to see a lot more from Karim Zidan in 2016. Going to talk to you about 2016 in just a second, but I want to say a big thank you to, obviously, all the guests, Johny Hendricks, Randy Couture, Max Holloway, and Karim Zidan, and, of course, you guys for listening. We always appreciate the listeners. We really couldn't do a single thing without you guys, but we will be taking a quick 2-week break just because of the holidays. You know, we've got Christmas, we've got New Year's, we've got a whole bunch of other holidays and gypsy festivals in between that we like to do and take part in. So a quick 2-week break for the boys. We'll be back on the 10th of January, or the weekend of the 10th of January. I believe that's a Sunday in America. It's going to be a Monday morning here in Australia. So 2 weeks without Submission Radio. I'm sure you guys will enjoy the break as well. I feel like there's been so many MMA events recently. I think MMA fans will enjoy the sort of the break, because the burnout is absolutely real. In the meantime, obviously, don't forget to follow us on Twitter at SubmissionAUS. Jump on Facebook, facebook.com/submissionradioAU. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. We will still be pumping out content. So Technique of the Week, that doesn't stop. That's year-long. All 365, well, not 365, basically every week, the whole year, we've got a whole bunch of sexy techniques coming. We may even pump out just a few fun little clips. You know, we've been around for almost 2 years now, so there's some things that, you know, our new listeners may not have even checked out. We might put up some short clips on the YouTube channel, and of course, if you're listening now, hey, if you have a few spare seconds, don't be afraid to give us a quick review on iTunes or Stitcher or TuneIn or SoundCloud or anywhere where you guys listen. The reviews really help us, especially through iTunes. But that's pretty much it. And the final episode of 2015. Before we go, as is customary, Dennis, any final words for the listeners?
Well, Cass, people know that throughout the year, I have given a review here and there, a movie review, and we do judge them based on Timothy Johnson's mustaches. God bless that mustache. So before we go, I thought, final episode, what's bigger than a Star Wars review? So I'm going to let you guys know my Star Wars review, but I will say this, it is completely spoiler free. And anybody out there, by the way, who goes on Facebook or Twitter or anything and tries to ruin the experience for people, shame on you. How dare you? Stop doing it right now. You have a good hard look in the mirror. Stop destroying lives. You're terrible. Change yourself. Now, onto the review. 2015 has provided me with some pretty awesome movie experiences with Bridge of Spies, Creed, The Martian, Ex Machina, and Straight Outta Compton. However, I couldn't wait to watch the new Star Wars. Again, I've said it before, but J.J. Abrams absolutely did the right thing by not giving anything away in the trailer and keeping the plot secret until it comes out. The new Batman trailer, for example, really frustrated me, as it gave away the whole plot of the movie right up to the final battle. So FYI, if you haven't watched the latest one that came out about a few weeks ago, make sure you don't watch it. It's just an absolute disgrace. But anyway, back to the review. I think we've all accepted the fact that George Lucas didn't recreate the same awesome vibe in his prequel movies. Although I must admit, I loved Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. And to those saying it's the worst movie out of the prequels, I say pod racing scene, Liam Neeson as a Jedi, and Darth Maul, and the final battle was all super awesome. So stop complaining, people. Get behind it. Now, the movie. It gives you the Star Wars feel you've been waiting for all these years. Prepare to take a roller coaster ride like no other, with laughs, intense battles, love, and drama. This was the most enjoyable movie experience I've had in the last few years. This is a movie made for the cinemas. It's made for the whole experience. Never did I enjoy reaching across for my popcorn and Choc Top any more than when I went and watched Star Wars. It kept me on the edge of my seat until the very end. People said it was awesome. Rotten Tomatoes gave it 94%. I went in with high expectations, and the movie met all of them and even blew me away a little bit. Are you waiting to watch this movie on DVD? Don't make that mistake. This is a cinema movie. Don't miss the opportunity to see it on a big screen with an excited crowd. But I must warn you, you have to avoid the spoilers at all costs. Otherwise, you just will not have the same experience. So how many Timothy Johnson mustaches does this one get, Casper? Well, I'll answer you. 4.5. It's a real classic. And for those who have a whiny girlfriend who don't like Star Wars like me, maybe just leave them at home and watch it with your friends that enjoy Star Wars. Don't ruin the first time. And then later on, if they want to watch it, bring them along. But I'm telling you this right now, this is not a date movie. You don't want any distractions. There's a lot to digest in this movie, and you've been waiting for this movie for a really long time. So make sure you go with a group that appreciate it, and you're going to have a great time. But apart from that, Cass, yeah, it was honestly my most enjoyable movie experience over the last few years.
Wow, I'm scared, because I've always known you as by far the harshest movie critic ever, and a lot of times when you bring movies down, I think, oh, this is going to be a shit fest, and then I watch it, and I'm like, wow, that actually wasn't too bad. So I rely on you and on your negativity. But now, there's so much positivity, I'm scared. My expectations are going to be through the roof. And I think the last time that happened was, I think, Avatar, that movie with the blue people and stuff, which was kind of cool, but it just wasn't as amazing as everybody said. And I think that's something that you said was pretty good. So I don't know. I'm pretty scared now. But there you go. Star Wars, spoiler free. And for the record, I don't watch any trailers anymore because they do spoil everything. So you're absolutely right about that. Again, thank you so much for tuning in. The last movie review for the year, the last submission ready for the year. We'll catch you guys next year.